everybody. Welcome to the Directors Club podcast. I'm your host, Patrick Ripoll, once again. And today I am joined by someone who, at this point, is probably more recently associated with this podcast than I am, Bill Ackerman. Bill, how are you doing?
Doing pretty good. As I told you before we started, I'm sitting on the floor of my parents' basement because this is the only place where we can get a clear internet signal. But happy to talk to you about... the films of Tsai Ming-Liang today.
Tsai Ming-Liang is a filmmaker about liminal spaces. So sort of making unintended use of the cold, unfinished basement floor is really within the spirit of the whole thing.
Unfortunately, it's not like a flooded basement, so it's only going to really remind me of his film so much. But, you know, we'll do what we can.
Right. So last time we got together on this podcast, we talked about a ethnically Chinese displaced art house darling who made films about people who are lonely and struggling to connect that are sort of infused with his quirky sense of humor. But this time we're talking about Tsai Ming-Liang and not Wong Kar-wai. So it's going to be a very different episode.
Yeah, no, I guess what I want to ask you with just getting started here, can you tell me what the first film of his you saw was? I don't think I know this.
So I had never heard of Tsai Ming-Liang before. All of his most well-known years of being sort of a festival darling, if not someone who crosses over and makes much money at the box office anywhere, were sort of dark years for me where I wasn't really paying attention to film culture in that way. Also, this is an episode on a Taiwanese filmmaker with a lot of Taiwanese cast and crew and all of that. And as I think I also brought this up in the Wong Kar-wai episode, everyone deserves to have their names pronounced correctly. Probably not going to do it. I recorded a lecture of Tsai Ming-Liang that I attended, and one of the two speakers beforehand said Tsai Ming-Liang and one said Tsai Ming-Liang. So I honestly, like, right at the start, very uncertain if I'm supposed to be saying Tsai Ming-Liang or Tsai Ming-Liang. But at any rate, my introduction to Tsai Ming-Liang was the Gene Siskel Film Center had a program that was retrospective of all of his films. I want to say this is around, like, 2015 or 2016, because I was working at the video store at the time. And it was one of those things where I saw it on the schedule and I never heard the name before. And I said, all right, well, that probably isn't too important. I've never heard this person before. But one of the movies was called Rebels of the Neon God. And I went, that is the coolest film title I've ever heard. Clearly, this is some sort of like crazy, you know, rebel without a cause meets cyberpunk kind of movie. And I was like, I got to see that eventually. I didn't see any of those movies at the Gene Siskel, but I did work at a video store. So there was a year where I was trying to make a concentrated effort to watch a lot more Asian films. And, you know, I saw Rebels of the Neon God on DVD from there. And it was like right in about of like I saw Rebels of the Neon God and Millennium Mambo and Unknown Pleasures. And there was all these movies that felt like very of a piece. So, we'll talk about Rebels of the Neon God. It's a very atypical Tsai Ming-Liang movie in many ways. And so to me, I took it not as like, oh, what an interesting film from this, you know, idiosyncratic auteur. I took it as like just of a broader piece about, you know, Chinese movies about sort of alienated youth who are, you know, lonely and melancholy. So that was my first experience with Tsai Ming-Liang. What was your first experience with Tsai Ming-Liang?
I guess it was December 6th, 2005 was the first time I saw it. I have this because I recorded it because I had rented it from Netflix DVD, but it was What Time Is It There? I was a big film comment reader, and film comment I started reading regularly in 2001. And I think at the time, they were focusing on a lot of international directors that weren't quite like the big moneymaker, like Siskel and Ebert appearances. They were kind of just being embraced like on the Lincoln Center, like film festivals and such. Like I'm thinking of people like Ho Sho Shen and Bellatar, and I never know how to say his name. It's Pichapong Vrasathakal, Olivier Assayas, the Dardens, Pedro Costa, and Tsai Ming-Liang was part of that. But all these directors, a lot of them that fall under that kind of umbrella term of slow cinema, which I'm sure we'll talk about. But a lot of them, I kind of racket together in my head because I was reading about them for a while before I actually saw any of the films, and I didn't know anyone that knew any of this stuff. I think at the time, like, the big people in art house were like people like Michael Haneke and Catherine Breillat and Von Trier, and so, like, these were more austere and less genre. I mean, Rebels of Neon Gone, God aside, like, I think a lot of these are not really genre films. They're just straight up contemplative art house films. And I think when I got to What Time Is It There, I didn't quite get it. I didn't dislike it, but I didn't quite get it either. Like, I think I'd never, like, I'd seen Tarkovsky and Bresson and Antonioni. Like, I was familiar with, like, slower pacing, but, and since we mentioned Wong Kar-wai, I was familiar with, like, that kind of more French New Wave kind of pop sensibility kind of Asian cult film, but I wasn't really familiar with something like this. That the scenes played out that long, and the comedy, I mean, I recognized that he was playing, like, with deadpan comedy. Like, I got that it was, like, half comedy, half tragic, but yeah, it was just a tone I didn't quite know what to do with at the time. And then I didn't really see anything from him for a few years after that. Rebels of the Neon God and The Wayward Cloud were what I came to later, and then I don't know if I really connected with him again until Days in 2020. So it was kind of a great catch-up, kind of preparing for this, to see things like Stray Dogs that I had meant to see and had not, and things like The Hole and The River that I had read about forever but just, you know, had never gotten around to them. So I don't know, it's not a career that I have totally got a beat on, and I know that you did a lot of research for this and know way more about him than I do, so I'm gonna probably learn a few things as we talk about this.
Yeah absolutely. We brought up some of this already in just sort of talking about our experiences with his movies, but generally, the thing you would know Chai Ming-Liang for, there's one film that sort of stands above his others, like, it's on the Sight and Sound list. It's one of only a handful of Chinese language films on the Sight and Sound, you know, top 250 films of all time list, Goodbye Dragon Inn. Not a film that necessarily, yeah, slots into a genre comfortably. It's a movie that I love so much, but it's very hard to recommend. But it might also be a good sort of way to explain what his approach is, which is he makes these slower paced films. He focuses on sort of place, environments. He makes films about loneliness, about characters sort of are who are full of longing, who are constantly reaching out to each other in ways that, but never quite connecting. His films are sort of about dissatisfaction. But another part of Goodbye Dragon Inn is that it's also like it does have that half tragedy, half comedy thing that Bill brought up, where it's got this sort of Jacques Tati sensibility where there's a lot of like silent comedy going on.
And that's one that I think is where I really kind of got it with him as far as like what he was up to, because I think that was, I mean, because I think Rebels of the Neon God, I think, is almost kind of like a different kind of film, but of what you associate with him as far as that slower pacing, I think Goodbye Dragon Inn is where I kind of came to understand what he was doing. And I guess that is going to be, you know, since you mentioned Sight and Sound, Paul, and Nick Pinkerton wrote a great monograph on it. I think that one is getting more attention, has a nice Blu-ray from Second Run. That might be pushed as like his Jean Dielman or whatever, like as far as like the signature film. But I mean, when I was getting into him, I think What Time Is It There and Rebels of the Neon God were like the two most popular ones.
And those definitely are much more traditional narrative films. And those were the ones that I really gravitated to. Like when I liked What Time Is It There, I liked how much it reminded me of Rebels of the Neon God. And then first time I saw Goodbye Dragon Inn, I was like, what the hell is this? Nothing happens. There's a shot that lasts for 7 minutes of just like an empty theater. This is just like too far. He's just pushing it to the breaking point. I came around, and we will talk in depth on Goodbye Dragon Inn, but generally speaking, things you need to sort of know about Chai Ming-Liang, and I do feel the need to sort of introduce him broadly to people in a way that many of the other directors I've covered, I don't, because his work is so hard to see, and because he is more obscure than a lot. You know, Tony Scott is a director I've done on here. You don't need me to explain Tony Scott to you, but I totally understand people who have not seen many of these films because, you know, on home video, they're difficult to see, And be just because they are in their pace and in their sort of alienating emotional states, they are a little bit more challenging than the average sort of crossover art house fare. But, you know, slow pace, sense of humor, sense of alienation, sense of environment. He's a gay filmmaker, and that queer sexuality is threaded through pretty much every single one of his movies. In you know, always in sort of fascinating indirect ways. There are not many movies that are about like a gay community or like a gay relationship. They're mostly about sort of longing and the feeling of isolation one feels. That's basically the filmmaking style in general. We can get more into specifics. We're going to be talking about four films on this podcast, sort of. To exemplify the arc of his career, because he is someone who started making movies. His first theatrical feature films in 1992. His most recent one came out in 2020. And the difference in the sensibility and the pace and the feeling and what he's attempting and sort of the worlds outside of theatrical film exhibition that he has dipped into since then all inform a pretty dramatic career arc, despite the fact that his work kind of all feels like one big movie. There's so many repeating elements. So what we're going to do is we're going to cover four movies, but we're also going to be covering these elements that keep popping up. And in those elements, we're sort of discuss the other works in his filmography. The four movies we're going to discuss are his first movie from 1992, Rebels of the Neon God. We're going to be talking about What Time Is It There from 2001. We're going to be talking about Goodbye Dragon Inn from 2003. And we're going to be talking about Stray Dogs from 2013. Before we get into any of that, I do have a little bit of biography. Chai Ming-Liang was born in Malaysia in 1957. He was a second-generation Chinese immigrant, and his parents were farmers who also ran a noodle stall. He was largely raised by his doting grandparents, who instilled a love of cinema in him by constantly taking him to movies as a young man. They even did his homework and schoolwork for him so that he wouldn't have to do it, and he instead could feel free to wander around Malaysia and daydream. In 1977, he moved to Taiwan to enroll in the Taipei Chinese Cultural University to study dramatic art. That's right. He began his career in the arts not as a filmmaker at all, but as a playwright, which I think is sort of an interesting, important part of the puzzle in how he arrives at his sensibility. In the early 80s, he wrote, directed, and occasionally starred in three avant-garde plays. Those plays are Instant Bean Sauce Noodle, A Sealed Door in the Dark, and A Wardrobe in the Room. And those plays tackled themes of sadomasochistic power, gay love, queer identity, loneliness, confinement, all things that will continue to pop up in his filmography all the way to 2020. Like most Taiwanese directors of his generation, he got his start on television, writing for a primetime soap opera called Endless Love. This led to his feature directorial debut, the 1989 TV movie All the Corners of the World, which depicted the life of a family in the margins of Taipei society who make a living scalping tickets. 2 years later, he made Boys, his first film with debuting actor Lee Kang-sheng, who would go on to become his muse and even a domestic partner of sorts. It's a very fascinating relationship the two have, and we'll get into all of that. But Lee Kang-sheng will go on to be in every single one of Chai Ming-Liang's movies from now on, and it's kind of impossible to talk about the work of Chai Ming-Liang without talking about the performances of Lee Kang-sheng. Boys was a film about divisions between the middle and lower class in Taipei and the ways that a juvenile delinquent and a petty thief lashes out in frustration over his life, which perhaps makes this the perfect transition point to talk about the first film we're going to be discussing, his theatrical debut, Rebels of the Neon God. Rebels of the Neon God stars Lee Kang-sheng as Shao Kang. Shao Kang is a character that pops up in most of the films of the first 10 years of Tsai Ming-Liang's career. Thing about that is he the same character in all of these movies, or is he just playing a similar person with the same name? We can get into that as well. Shao Kang is a schoolboy who's in a cram school, who drops out of a cram school to sort of and takes the tuition that he gets refunded to him and sort of just wanders around Taipei blowing the money in arcades and stuff like that. He becomes fixated on a juvenile delinquent and petty criminal, Ah Che, played by Chen Chao Jung, who would also go on to appear in several Chai Ming-Liang movies. Ah Che and his best friend Ah Ping have a love triangle with Ah Kui, who is played by Wang Yuen. And so there you have these sort of three parallel occasionally intersecting narratives where Xiao Kang, the cram school dropout, is following these juvenile delinquents, and you wonder, is he longing after them sexually? Is he longing after the freedom that he perceives them to have? Is he wishing that he could, you know, be as cool as them? You also get the narrative of these juvenile delinquents and sort of how bleak their life is, and just, you know, the crimes they pull off involve breaking into phone boxes and like robbing an arcade and like really low level stuff that gets them into, you know, hot water. And you get the feeling through the apartment that Atsi lives in that's constantly flooding that, you know, life is kind of bleak for those in the lower class. And they might even possibly serve as a warning of what Xiao Kang's life could be like if he doesn't, you know, go to college, if he doesn't, you know, elevate into the middle class, what life in the lower class Taipei, how desperate it is. And then you also follow the lives of Xiao Kang's parents, played by Liu Yingqing, who's his mother, and Miao Tian, who is his father. Liu Yingqing and Miao Tian will also appear in the next several movies by Chai Ming-Liang as Li Kangsheng's parents. The apartment they live in was Li Kangsheng's actual apartment, and they would use that same apartment to shoot several future movies. So there is this continuity there where you're following Xiao Kang and his mother and father in the same apartment as they get older. But this first film, I want to ask Bill, what do you think about Rebels of the Neon God?
I love it. I think it's one of the most traditionally entertaining movies he made. And it's funny because I had never seen, we don't have to go into them in depth, but I'd never seen All the Corners of the World or Boys prior to preparing for this. And I enjoyed those both as well. And those are both kind of coming of age youth melodrama stories that I think have a lot in common with Rebels of the Neon God. So I was surprised how much they reminded me of, like, maybe just more conventional takes on this kind of milieu. But this feels like the transition into the kind of things he does with Li Kang Shang later on, as far as like making him more the focus. Like here, he's almost kind of like stalking a more traditional kind of film, because it's like you have the hood love triangle thing, which, you know, I mean, we talk about things like Ashes of Time or Mean Streets or Scarface. I mean, there's a lot of, you know, love triangle crime kind of thing. And not that these are like heavy criminals. I mean, they try to pull off some kind of meager heist. They remind me of those kind of like Mean Streets characters, and they're aspiring maybe to some kind of crime life. But they're also just kids and just goofing off too. So it has a lot of the kind of romantic depiction of, like, you know, kids like flirting and riding around on motorbikes at night, and, you know, like he uses this kind of recurring synthesizer hook kind of song that is also quite different from like what you get into later, as far as like having, like, you know, the kind of coolness of like a, you know, whatever, like a Michael Mann or a, you know, a Refn, like some kind of like cool synthesizer at night kind of atmosphere that is really not what you get in the later films. So like that kind of,
I believe this is the only film that has a non-diegetic score.
You know, you could be right. I can't remember if there's anything in Viva L'Amour, but yeah, it definitely stands apart in that respect as well. But then you have the story, you know, with Li Kangsheng kind of stalking them and stalking the leader. Is it Asi? Stalking him in a way that I always took it to be attraction. But I mean, what you're saying is other motives for it. I mean, those are there also. It recreates a moment in All the Corners of the World as far as the kind of violent way that he expresses that frustration by like attacking his vehicle in a way that is kind of similar to a moment in All the Corners of the World, as far as not like that the person is like dangerously, you know, like stalking to hurt somebody, but their sexual frustration comes out in other ways that are violent. That it's interesting because you don't know, like, it creates a tension, like you don't know what this character is really up to. Is it just that they are, and the fact that like that it's, there's a homophobia to the attack also, right, suggests a kind of like a self-hated closeted thing that is,
he spray paints the word AIDS onto his motorbike.
Yeah, and so it's, I don't know, it's, I mean, I don't want to give away every beat of the story, not that it's too heavy on plot, because it is basically a lot of hanging out with these characters and observing them, but it's not quite as static as the kind of thing he gets into later. Like, it is, it does feel like a cool youth movie that just has a lot of the traces of what he's going to develop in the mature style. I mean, because it's got, like, the imagery that you would find with, like, the flooded, you know, the flooded floors and things that, like, I associate with, like, you know, what's to come. But I think as a gateway in, I think this is probably the best place to start for a neophyte. And it has a Blu-ray in the U.S., so it has, like, it's easier to see a good-looking version of this than maybe some of the other films that come later. I'd seen this one before, but, like, I've rewatched it twice, you know, prior to us talking today, and it only just grows on me more and more each time I watch it.
Yeah, I in general, the work of Chiming Liang, the first time I see a movie, I can only sort of walk on the surface of it. Mm-hmm. And especially in preparing for this episode, in watching all of these movies, it's especially easy to sort of get all of these inroads into these subtexts and hidden meanings and more subtle things that are going on. But, like, the first time I saw this movie, I loved it because it was just that, like, really attractive, like, youth movie where, like, Taipei is so beautiful in this movie. It's a very exciting location. It feels bursting with life and people. There's, like, crowded shots in malls, and that's and food courts and things like that. And
arcades,
that's
too, yeah.
Arcades. The mall and food courts and that sort of thing is a constant thing throughout all of these movies, that you're just constantly seeing these open-air markets. You have the motorcycles. You have the arcades. Again, like, I love video games and stuff, so, like, just seeing these, like, classic arcades and seeing, you know, the little details of, well, of course, Capcom isn't going to make a separate, they call them bezel, is the sort of plastic cards that go on the sides of arcades that say the name and have the artwork and everything on the machines. Mm-hmm. And of course, they're not going to go through the trouble of doing a Taiwanese specific bezel. So you just have the Chinese language Street Fighter machine with a post-it note that has the Taiwanese title, like, just on the front of it. And, like, there are little details like that of, like, oh, that was how what an arcade was like in 1992 in Taipei. You know, the thing across all these movies and across pretty much all of Taiwanese New Wave is that these are very low budget movies, and so they're mostly shot on location. There's very few sets built ever. And so many of these movies, part of the joy is the locations of them, are those environments we talked about. I do want to talk about Taiwanese New Wave in a slightly broader way, because Chiming Liang doesn't quite fit into the Taiwanese New Wave, but it's possible people don't know too much about the Taiwanese New Wave. You brought up that it feels like someone stalking a more conventional movie. What it feels like specifically is someone stalking a conventional Taiwanese New Wave movie. A Brighter Summer Day came out the year before, and it, all of these love triangles and the petty crime and the violence and the youth feeling totally repressed by, like, there's a shot in Rebels of the Neon God where he does go to cram school and he gets there late, so he has to go in the back of the class, and you see, like, the camera pan over and it is like 90 students crammed into this classroom, and you know for a fact, like, anyone sitting in the back has no chance of hearing what the teacher's saying. And it really is just, like, in a single shot, it sums up, like, it's a very pointed critique of the educational system in Taipei. And there are so many Hao Shei-Shen movies and Edward Yang movies where you have that anxiety over school and about getting into a good school and about upward mobilization. And all of that stuff is the parts that make Rebels of the Neon God such a strange, it makes it a strange object in the Chiming Liang oeuvre, because so few of his films feel traditional in that way. And you can almost see this, you can almost read this as Xiao Kang is Chiming Liang, and the more conventional narrative is the thing that he can't quite bring himself to tell, and he is sort of, like, on the outside, like, feeling jealous of these other filmmakers who can connect to audiences, and he knows that his own instincts are not nearly so commercial. And eventually, the story of Chiming Liang's career is the story of him embracing the anti-commercial side of himself. And so, like, it could be fascinating going back and watching this and reading it as a comment on his own place within the film industry that he's a part of. Now, the Taiwanese New Wave, I can't get into the history of Taiwan because it's very complicated. The important thing to know is that Taiwan is a island that has constantly been under colonial rule of one kind or another. The Dutch, Chinese generals, during World War II, it was under the rule of Japan. The big changeover, the really traumatic part of Taiwanese history that most of Taiwanese New Wave films like to focus on is the White Terror, which is the approximately 40 years that the entirety of Taiwan was under martial law. It was very difficult living in Taiwan. There was a lot of paranoia about the infiltration of communists. Watch a movie like A Brighter Summer Day or Hao Xiexian's City of Sadness. That's a good history of sort of the effect that had on it. And Hao Xiexian, director of City of Sadness, director of
Millennium Mambo.
Well, yeah, Time to Live, A Time to Die, Flowers of Shanghai. He's probably the most well-known name of the Taiwanese New Wave. The other most well-known name would be Edward Yang, who directed Brighter Summer Day. He directed Yi Yi. He directed The Terrorizers.
Is that Taipei Story? Is that him?
Taipei Story is that's probably one that is easier to see than some of his others. That's a brilliant movie. A lot of these movies, the thing they have in common is that they are historical films, and they are looking back at that time period, that sort of traumatic time period of white terror. And Taiwanese New Wave is a very important film movement that emerged in the early 80s as white terror was beginning to end. It didn't end officially until 1987, but the sort of strong grip that the government had on the Taiwanese film industry and the kind of movies that could get made, that loosened a bit at the start of the early 80s. And you had all of these filmmakers who went through these traumatic experiences who are finally sort of stepping up and saying, like, this is what it is to be Taiwanese. These are the things that we went through. And it really made a big splash into the world cinema scene. There's a very good documentary about it called Flowers of Taipei that I recommend you watch. It's on Mubi if you want to know the history of the Taiwanese New Wave. But suffice to say, it was this kind of upstart, out-of-nowhere film movement that happened in the 80s that, you know, made a big splash at all these film festivals and stuff. And if you watch that documentary, Flowers of Taipei, Chai Ming-Liang shows up at the end as, like, the evil final boss who, this entire movie, I'm watching it, and I'm trying to think, like, when are they going to bring up Chai Ming-Liang? Chai Ming-Liang. It cuts to him. He's sitting in a cafe. He takes a sip from his coffee. He says, I don't think I'm part of the Taiwanese New Wave. I just kind of make movies for myself. It's a personal thing, making movies. And then it cuts away. That's it. And like, I think that is true. Like, there are some who have tried to talk about the second Taiwanese New Wave, and they put Chai Ming-Liang and someone like Ang Lee together in that way. I don't think of that. I think that's a very different thing. I don't think of those two directors as being connected, but I do think it's worth knowing a little something about the Taiwanese New Wave, and it's worth exploring, like, so many great films by Hao Xiexian and Edward Yang that we, you know, the films we mentioned are just are really, really good and worth seeing. But like, I think about Chai Ming-Liang's career in opposition to the Taiwanese New Wave. He makes films that are fiercely personal. He makes films that are fiercely modern. A lot of, like, especially Hao Xiexian films are, like, very provincial, and his movies are fiercely urban. And Rebels of the Neon God, as being his theatrical debut, I always think about it in that way.
Yeah, I mean, with the directors that you're naming, I have to say that, like, as somebody that was reading about a film like A Brighter Summer Day, it was impossible to see it for a long time in the U.S. I mean, it was, like, it was bootlegs only to see that. I mean, until Criterion, like, put out the restored version, like, within the last 10 or so years. I mean, it was I had books that had stills from it, but you couldn't find it. Same with things like The Puppet Master or Dust in the Wind. Like, a lot of those films from that wave of, Hao Xiexian and Edward Yang. I mean, until you get to things like Yi Yi and the Criterion Collection putting that out, and like, it got easier, and things like Millennium Mambo got, like, proper distribution right away, but I feel like they were playing festivals and, like, they were critically well-regarded, but, like, it wasn't even, like, yeah, like, you couldn't really, like, easily get them on home video in the U.S. for, like, a long time. And you still can't get a lot of them. And I think that that's, I don't know, when you compare it to something like the French New Wave or the Czech New Wave or like any kinds of, you know, cinema de look or whatever, like in the 80s. Like, people could rent this stuff and make up their own mind or see it somehow. But I think that with the Taiwanese New Wave, it was really... Like, these films are not getting, like, a theatrical push the way maybe some of those earlier New Waves got, like, in select cities. And there was just... The way most people that were into art films and foreign films saw things by the 80s would have been on home video. And it was just harder to see them. Even in the DVD era, it was hard to see a lot of these films. I think even now, a film like The Puppet Master is a film I've always heard about, but it's, like, you could get, like, a really kind of muddy... like bad transfer, like Fox Lorber DVD, I think at one point, or Wellspring, but like you'd always read bad reviews because of the transfer. So it's just, you're waiting for like companies like Criterion or Arrow or whoever to put them out. But, you know, we'd each move to a new format, like things get lost in the shuffle. I mean, when we talk about the home video treatment of Simon Liang, it's like a lot of key films had like DVDs, but then when the DVDs went out of print, they just, you know, they're on the back channel sites now, and that's how you get them.
Absolutely. The one thing, though, that the Taiwanese New Wave and Chai Ming-Liang have in common is that they were film movements that were mostly appreciated. I mean, it was a film movement, and his body of work, both mostly appreciated outside of Taiwan. There's a very funny scene in All the Corners of the World where this family of ticket scalpers, they're having the mom and dad are having an argument in the living room as the child sits and listens in the bed about, you know, what are the tastes of Taiwanese audiences? What are the tickets that we should be getting up early and going to scalp? And they're having an argument about, like, no one wants to see A City of Sadness. They want to see Rocky. and the little kid is, you know, the little kid, even this little Taiwanese kid looks up and he sees Sylvester Stallone on his bedroom wall. That is something that is very true of Taiwanese New Wave. They were criticized in Taiwan that they made movies that were not commercial. They made movies that were too difficult. They were too slow. They were not accessible in a way that alienated domestic audiences. And Chai Ming-Liang, he eventually incorporates the love that France has for his work, eventually becomes a big part of several of his films. He is an officer of arts and letters for the French Ministry of Culture. Like, he is a almost honorary French citizen. And it is because in Taiwan, there is not really a market for the art house film. So that is something that the two do share. I wanted to talk to you because this is now the first film we're talking about in depth. We will be talking about Li Kangsheng and all of them. I find Li Kangsheng to be such an interesting figure. He is not a Tony Leung. He is not like this like matinee idol, handsome, charismatic person who like you instantly sit up straight, you know, the first time you see Chungking Express and go, wow, who is that?
Right.
The first time I saw some of these movies, it didn't occur to me that this was the same person, because it was just like I was watching so many Asian language movies all in a row. I didn't remember Li Kangsheng from Rebels of the Neon God. It did, like, despite the fact he has the same parents in the same apartment, that like never clicked with me until I like watched a couple more and go, oh, wait a second. But he has such a very interesting screen presence. I was wondering if you had words for like Li Kangsheng in this movie and other movies, like what his presence adds to these films, like how he is distinct. I mean, he was a non-actor. The interesting thing about his story. Go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say, I feel like, not that he's a bad actor, but I feel like he doesn't over-emote in a way that feels like, it reminds me of like the, maybe like the neorealist Italian films. Like, it's like somebody that can be in a scene and be natural in a scene, but doesn't like, Or the Czech New Wave Miloš Forman films, where he like uses real people that he finds that are not, and puts them in scenes with professional actors. You can sometimes tell that the people that are not professional actors don't deliver big performance. Like they're very kind of withdrawn, and like they I feel like he gets more expressive over time, but what the films feel like to me is like, it's like Simon Lang is just too fascinated with this guy to like let him go, and he keeps making films with him in prominent lead. He definitely works in all of them. Like it's not like it's a drawback to them, but it's interesting because it's almost like he's waiting for this guy to be more expressive, but instead the kind of low key energy of this actor kind of impacts the films, and they become more withdrawn along with him.
That is really the key, and that is factually correct in terms of, at least in, factually, whatever. It's in terms of what Chai Ming-Liang has said in interviews. The way he met Li Kangsheng is fascinating, because he was at an arcade doing location scouting, and he saw this kid that he thought looked like James Dean, which I don't see it, but God bless him. He just looked fascinating. And what he was doing in the arcade was he was working as a lookout, because there was illegal gambling going on in the back room of the arcade. So he already was this like very low level criminal. And he got to know Li Kangsheng, and they spent time together. And Rebels of the Neon God, the plot comes from the fact that Li Kangsheng was being pressured by his parents to go to cram school, and he was having all this anxiety about his academic life and stuff like that. And that was what inspired this movie. During the filming of this movie, Chai Ming-Liang has said in multiple interviews he was constantly like pulling his hair out because he was trying to get Li Kangsheng to go faster, but the words he kept using was like, no, do it naturally. Like, I don't know why you're going so slow. Do it naturally the way a person would. And then Li Kangsheng replied, well, this is naturally how I am. I am just like a slow-paced kind of person. So the pace of this movie, you know, there's a lot of camera movement. There's, you know, there's dolly shots that like go through the arcade. There's the exciting motorcycle scenes, all that sort of thing. All that editing, like the energy of this movie feels very distinct from the rest of the work. And that is because the rest of the work is Chai Ming-Liang going, okay, I am instead going to change the movie to match Li Kangsheng's energy.
Yeah. Yeah. And I should stress, just in case I wasn't clear, like, it's not like he ever gives bad performances in any of this. It almost feels like they're written to work within his abilities as a non-actor.
Yeah, exactly. And you will see on as the films go on, other actors who have professional careers who work, you know, with Edward Yang or Ang Lee or people like that, like when they are in Chai Ming-Liang movies, they do not emote. And he also works with other non-actors. Lu Yiqing, who plays Xiao Kang's mother, She ran a coffee shop that Chai Ming-Liang was into. And a funny thing about her life story is that she was extremely, I was going to say superstitious, which is perhaps a denigrating way of saying spiritual, but she was a very spiritual person. And you see throughout these movies that Xiao Kang's mother is constantly reacting to things in, you know, looking for more spiritual approaches. The title Rebels of the Neon God comes from the fact that she thinks that Xiao Kang's misbehavior is because he is sort of a reincarnated trickster god from Chinese folklore, the Neon God. And that energy it inflicts all of her characters as well. So he's not the only non-actor, but even the professional actors, they frequently are very unemotive in a way that feels a stylistic choice, not a lack of ability. The other thing about him, I guess I'm going to bring this up now because I don't think I have it in my notes elsewhere. Li Kangsheng, in addition to being the muse of Chai Ming-Liang, eventually became his domestic partner. They have a queer relationship, which I mean in both senses of the word, which is their relationship kind of complicates your understanding of a simple gay straight binary. And also their relationship sounds very strange. They live together. They spend all their days together. Li Kangsheng is straight and Chai Ming-Liang is gay. And Chai Ming-Liang, I don't know if in interviews he has explicitly said he is romantically in love with Li Kangsheng, but it is, I believe, quite obvious from the from the life of Chai Ming-Liang, from how he has decided to dedicate his entire film career to him, from the films that he makes and how he shoots Li Kangsheng. Li Kangsheng's body is on display through so many of these movies. It's like the camera very lovingly gazes at his body, and they have made it work. There is interviews I have read where they talk about like, oh yeah, they'll be in France doing something or another, and Chai Ming-Liang will go to a gay bathhouse, and Li Kangsheng will just hang out outside and smoke, and then Chai Ming-Liang will come back out and say, all right, let's go get food, that it's like, well, that is the nature of their relationship. It's,
well, have you seen, I assume you've seen everything I've seen, but have you seen Afternoon, the 2015?
Unfortunately, I was not able to see Afternoon.
Okay, I have watched that. It's it's interesting, but it's, and it's included for anyone that wants to see it. It might be streaming, but I know that it's definitely included as a bonus feature for the Blu-ray for Days. From Film Movement, I think, put that out. I think it's Film Movement, but it's but the Blu-ray that you can find for Days has the entirety of that film, which is over 2 hours long. Like, it's a feature length film, but it is just an extended conversation with the two of them sitting at a table talking, and it's mostly Simon Lang talking, and you know, occasional interjections from from Li Kang Sheng, but it's interesting because, he does seem like he's completely in love with that actor, and that actor feels like, he accepts it, and it's just like he's very kind of taciturn. It's very strange, and they've worked together for decades, so it's like they clearly have like a closeness and a love, but it's like, it's such a strange dynamic just like on camera, just the two of them engaging with one another.
I might make sense to contrast them with someone else, and it brings me to another thing I want to bring up. The relationship that, the working relationship that Chai Ming-Liang has with Li Kang-sheng, in terms of Li Kang-sheng constantly appearing in these films as this character Shao Kang. Again, debatable whether or not any of these movies are connected. The only undebatable one is that What Time Is It There and The Skywalk Is Gone and The Wayward Cloud are three movies that about the same characters. The Wayward Cloud is a direct sequel to What Time Is It There, which we can talk about a little later. But generally speaking, there's not anything connecting the events of any of these films. But there is a parallel here between François Truffaut and Jean-Pierre Liaud. But the very vital difference here is that François Truffaut made many films without Jean-Pierre Liaud, and Jean-Pierre Liaud made many films without François Truffaut, which is not the case here.
An actor relationship that I thought of, El Hedi Ben Salem, or Salam, the actor from Ali, Fears the Soul, and a few of other Fassbinder films, but he was Fassbinder's, lover and muse and lead actor for a minute. And I think about, had that dynamic been like carried out through the arc of Fassbinder's career, I mean, it kind of flamed out kind of quickly, but that kind of dynamic is what I was thinking of also, because like that guy, he's not always the most expressive actor, but there's like some kind of charisma about him, and the director's camera clearly loves him, and you can feel that, and that kind of carries those films in a way. And I feel like that you can get that here too, although he does play like a similar character in a number of films, but like there's a variety to what he gets to do over the course of the career. I mean, something like Stray Dogs, just for one example, is a lot more demanding part for him than something like Rebels of the Neon God, I think.
Oh yes, absolutely. I guess there are also several examples of directors who are married to actresses, people like Fellini and Giulietta Messina, or Rob Zombie and Sherry Moon Zombie, people like that.
Bergman and Lee Vollman, yeah.
But because of the nature of their relationship, and because the entire body of work is dedicated to him, and the plots of these movies reflect the things that happen in Li Kang-sheng's real life in a way that, again, like you said, like he puts him in situations where he can be natural because he doesn't have to stretch as an actor or anything. It's just, I can't think of anything else quite like it. The last sort of element of Rebels of the Neon God that I want to discuss in terms of Chai Ming-Liang's work is the central visual metaphor that he returns to again and again, which is the use of water. Water flowing, water sort of seeping in, water dripping through walls, water coming through holes in the ceiling, people drinking glasses of water, people drinking out of water bottles. In Rebels of the Neon God, it's sort of the one visual element of the film that feels outside of the realm of a somewhat documentary-like objective eye that the camera has, where this apartment just keeps flooding and draining periodically. With 3 inches of water, you're just constantly seeing puddles start leaking across the tiles, things floating, cigarette butts. This is specifically the apartment of Ah Chi. to a certain extent, like on a pure narrative level, it is sort of demonstrating what a bad, you know, apartment building it is. It's also an apartment building where the elevator keeps stopping at the fourth floor every time, which is a fun detail. But it's just sort of like we are demonstrating the squalor of his life and sort of his lower class status. But the expressive nature of the way Chai Ming-Liang uses water in this and, you know, much more pointedly in other films, is it goes far beyond just narrative device and becomes I have my own interpretation and I have my own sort of unifying theory of Chai Ming-Liang and water, but I did want to know what you thought about the use of water like throughout his body of work.
You know, I never thought about it in terms of like a symbolic meaning. I just thought it was an aesthetic that he felt like just drawn to, you know, incorporating that into the stories. Yeah, I mean, there's definitely a lot of flooded apartments and things floating away and bodies in water and droughts. And I mean, I did notice it, but I as far as like what he was trying to say, you know, with that recurring image, I hadn't thought about like any kind of greater. What do you see in it?
I don't believe it is like. It means the exact same thing in every single work. But generally speaking, I tend to find the water as an image of sort of this unrepressible emotion. The way water works in these movies so often is that like you can't stop it from coming in. It's going to come in. It's going to leak out. You know, he shoves a towel down the drain in his kitchen in Rebels of the Neon God. This drain in the kitchen is where the water is coming up from. And you just see this towel uncoil like a snake and float away. So many of these movies, the river, there is the leak in the father's bedroom that gets more and more severe. The downstairs apartment, you have all this water and other bodily fluids coming down from the hole in Li Kang Sheng's apartment into the woman's apartment. But also it's constantly raining every single day, every single shot. The only, for a movie that has so little dialogue, what you're constantly hearing in the hole is the patter of rain.
Well, and even in the river, you didn't mention that Li Kangsheng gets sick from acting in the water. I mean,
yes.
Yeah. Cause, I mean, there's a danger or a toxic quality to it as well.
Right. And so to me, it is this like, it functions as a barometer of longing, of repression, of intense dissatisfaction. I know in an interview, Chai Ming-Liang has said that he kind of views people like plants, and like people need love, like plants need water. And like when you see a ton of water around a person in one of his movies, that's a person who's drying up. And I think about that. I think about just like, these are so many movies about people who desperately need each other. Generally speaking, you have all these misconnections and they're just infinite longing, which again, for a gay man who is in love with a straight man, like it makes sense that he has this sort of like endless wellspring of longing and desire. Specifically, the thing about the image that is compelling is that it can't be repressed, is that it's always going to break through. In the river, the father sets up these like elaborate devices of plastic sheets in order to catch the water and like filter it out somewhere else. But then it breaks, so you have to get something else. One of the grossest and like most squalid images in any of these movies is in the hole when the woman, I forget the name of the actress who lives in the lower apartment, but she just buys like giant Costco sized things of napkins, and her whole house just becomes this like disgusting nest of wet napkins as she's like trying to sop up water with all these disposable napkins. And like there is this just feeling of like it can't be dealt with. As someone who watched Rebels of the Neon God initially and just appreciated on its most base pleasures, like that image of water was the thing that sort of made me stand up a little straighter and go like, I think there's something going on here. I mean, part of the other thing that's going on in Rebels of the Neon God is that every single character is just full of self-loathing in a way. Like this is not my favorite Chai Ming-Liang movie, but this was for a long time. And a lot of it was just like strongly relating to all of that self-loathing.
Yeah. I mean, I think when I think about his cinema, and I know that there's lots of exceptions, but I think of Unrequited Love and I think of Boredom you know, like for the characters. Yeah. I think of like characters that are like trapped or just lost. And I think that feeling seems to impact so many of them for me. And that's always kind of tricky. I mean, this is something I was going to say, like when we were like first setting out to do this, one of the earliest episodes of Director's Club that I heard was you and Jim getting into an argument over Somewhere, the Sofia Coppola movie. And I think about the trick of how do you tackle boredom in the lives of the characters without boring the viewer. And I know that you've recently did a new podcast with Jim about that particular film, and I won't spoil what your new take on it is, but you know, I think about that with the whole notion of slow cinema, like, because this is something that I think, I don't know that there's any real crossovers from that group of filmmakers into like a big success commercially. I mean, there are certain films like Satan Tango or Goodbye Dragon Inn. You know, I think, I don't know if Uncle Boonmi is considered part of that. I mean, there are certain films that like are well known and like art house hits in quotation marks.
I think even people who are casually interested in art house films have seen Stalker. It would be an example of that.
I guess so, but I mean, I think that Tarkovsky comes, I mean, he's working in genre. He's a little bit further back in time. I'm thinking of like that.
Sure.
I'm thinking of like that wave of films that come at the end of the 90s and into the early aughts.
Yes.
But I always felt like, you know, where we are now, you know, with, I think attention spans are probably on the whole growing shorter. I think theatrical exhibition is more and more on shaky ground, and certainly for non franchise blockbuster type cinema, that I think that like there's something like a filmmaker like Simon Lang, like it almost feels like in such defiance, like the kind of work he does is in such defiance of everything that's happening now as far as like how the medium is evolving, that it's going to be interesting to me to see how, because I think that people will discover and like new generations will fall in love with his films, but it feels like such, I mean, it always felt like a little bit of an oppositional kind of thing, but I feel like it only gets further and further from where I think the medium is going to go if it's going to meet the viewer at their level in terms of like what they can engage with. And I could be wrong. I'm not trying to sound like an old man or whatever. I just feel like,
yeah,
cinema could potentially move in a more small, quick, bite-sized direction, and Simon Liang's the kind of person that would have you unwrap the sandwich and finish that entire thing in the shot before he cuts to the next shot. Like, he's just somebody that is patient about witnessing an action. He's not quite as extreme in the Rebels of the Neon God era, but I mean, obviously, as we go forward, like, he's somebody that lets scenes play out in unbroken shots that feels very kind of counterintuitive to what, you know, commercial filmmaking kind of trains people to accept. And I think that even at the time of Rebels of the Neon God, I mean, this is before you really have the influence of Michael Bay on cinema, which really kind of happens a little bit later. But I think it's just accepted that shot lengths become cut like commercials or like videos. And like, it goes beyond montage, like scenes, like training montage kind of cutting, to like the entire thing being cut that way, which I think comes more from Bay than Scott. But I mean, I think, maybe both of them kind of in parallel. But like, I think that something like Goodbye Dragon Inn might feel the most approachable to me, even though it's one of the slowest, because it's got a compelling, well, I don't want to get ahead of ourselves as far as like why, but I mean, I think that, you know, there's a cult following that's growing for that film. And I mean, you know, we're talking in the period where Jean Dielman just topped the Sight and Sound poll. Like, so there's definitely like a reckoning with slower paced cinema that continues to happen, but it's just, I don't know. It watching all these films in quick succession for this, I was thinking about like how this is so counter to where I feel like things are headed in the larger culture. But
right.
I mean, there's always been an audience for films that are deliberate and considered and austere. But it's just, I don't know. I mean, these are even more demanding than I think what Tarkovsky or Bresson or Antonioni were up to in the 60s and 70s.
You know, I feel totally unqualified to ever make judgments about the taste of the masses or anything, because like I've seen Stray Dogs 5 times. Like, my brain is broken. I watched, we're going to talk about What Time Is It There. I watched What Time Is It There this most recent time, and I said, how could anyone think this is slow? This movie just keeps moving, and it's only because I was watching so many Chai Ming-Liang movies that didn't have any dialogue, that What Time Is It There has a surprisingly a lot of dialogue compared.
Yeah.
And so, like, my brain is broken in that way. But also, I have ADHD. There's not any movies that I don't stop and pause and then look at my phone, or, like, get up and get a bathroom and then get some water, and then I forget what I was doing, and then I see the pause movie and I go, oh, okay. Like, I've seen Stray Dogs 5 times. I've seen it all the way through without falling asleep twice. I saw it in the theater, and in this theater I started to nod off during the last 20 minutes, and I think that's fine. I mean, Chai Ming-Liang has specifically said, like, oh yeah, I don't mind if people fall asleep in my movies. I fall asleep at the movie theater all the time. But, like, I think that is also, Chai Ming-Liang is one of these directors. On the Wong Kar-wai episode, we talked about people like Spike Lee or Quentin Tarantino who understand that their personality is part of the auteur, and, like, part of the reason they get to keep making the movies they're making is because they're selling themselves as a brand. And Chai Ming-Liang is 100% that. Mm-hmm. We're going to talk a little bit later. Wong Kar-wai goes into sort of luxury brands and making commercials for Gucci and stuff like that. Chai Ming-Liang basically has the same arc, but just to a different bunch of rich people that he sells his brand to. You can't necessarily take anything he says in an interview at face value. He's very manipulative. There's a really funny story in this book, Taiwan Film Directors, A Treasure Island. There's a very funny story about a common thing he would do at film festivals is he would break down and cry over the fact that he couldn't get his movie seen and distributed, and that in Taiwan, box offices were, like, shutting him out and they wouldn't show his movies. And he's asking everyone who's in the audience for the Q&A or whatever to, like, please tell someone, please, I have no way of getting on to see my movies. And it was this, like, bomb that emotional bomb he would drop in this audience, because some people had seen him pull these waterworks, like, 7 times before and understood it was an act, and then they would start laughing, and then other people who thought it was real would be scandalized by people laughing at this poor broken crying man who just wants his movies to be seen. and it was like an example. The book goes on to sort of examine his films through the lens of camp, and it was used as an example of, like, the camp of Chai Ming-Liang. So anything he says in interviews, you should automatically be a little bit suspect. But at any rate, he says he doesn't mind if people fall asleep in his movies. I fall asleep during his movies. I don't mind that I do. I have fallen asleep during his movies. I pause a Daniel Craig James Bond movie and get distracted and look something up just as often as I do during the whole. So I just feel like I'm not qualified to answer what kind of future these films have for an audience. But I do think that any world that caters to one sensibility is going to foster in a certain kind of person an antagonistic anti that.
There's always going to be
movements that are, they don't just come out of, oh, these people just happen to want to make slow films. It's these people hate fast films and they want to do whatever they can to reject what they see as toxic or whatever. So I think there's always going to be an audience for slow cinema. But as we tackle the career of Chai Ming-Liang, we might see this audience maybe doesn't exist inside the multiplex or even the art house. I think we need to move on. The next film we're going to be talking about is from 2001. What Time Is It There? This sort of period in between 1992 and 2003, where he made Goodbye Dragon in. Chai Ming-Liang likes to sort of dismiss this period of his work as the first 10 years. And he'll talk about, oh yeah, people like the first 10 years. But he eventually grew to have very different sensibilities. And when you see programs of his movies, you're often seeing programs of movies that start with Goodbye Dragon Inn and the films after, because he is not as interested in these movies. But I will say that all of these films of the first 10 years are absolutely spectacular. I believe they are all great. We are not talking about these movies in depth. That is not a reason to think that they are lesser works. But I am going to go through sort of the next 9 years of his career in between 1992 and 2001. If Rebels of the Neon God put Chai Ming-Liang on the radar of the world outside of Taiwan, it was the work of the following 6 years that solidified his reputation, because in 1994, he released Vive L'Amour, which was a film about three people unwittingly sharing an apartment that tackled gentrification, homelessness, queer desire, and, you guessed it, loneliness. That one won the Golden Lion at the Venice International Film Festival, as well as winning Best Picture at Taiwan's Golden Horse Awards. It also set a tone and template that the next several of years of his career would follow. In 1997, Chai Ming-Liang followed up Vive L'Amour with The River, which is a film about a family divided and isolated from each other in the midst of a health crisis involving a mysterious ailment of the son's neck. This won the Silver Bear Grand Jury Prize at the Berlin International Film Festival, further cementing Chai Ming-Liang's legacy in the West, particularly in Europe. This is particularly relevant to Chai's next film, 1998's The Hole, which was funded by French money as part of a project called 2000 Seen By... it was a project that was designed to produce films that depicted the coming of the millennium from the perspective of 10 different countries. He was the only Asian filmmaker involved. The Hole is about an apocalyptic pandemic of an illness that makes people act like cockroaches, and the growing relationship between an upstairs and downstairs neighbor of an apartment building when a hole develops between their two units. Chai's now familiar rhythms and plots about isolation and the difficulty of human connection were joined by a whole new element in this film that would appear in future films, the unabashed camp of musical numbers set to corny 60s pop of Hong Kong singer Grace Chang. After Hole, he made a short experimental documentary called Fish Underground, A Conversation with God, which I don't personally believe is particularly notable as a work on its own, but it is worth noting that it marks the start of a trend that would continue for the rest of his career, where in between his features, he would experiment with form and aesthetics in short films that often mixed documentary and fiction, avant-garde and narrative. These works would slowly become more significant than his features as his career goes on. Eventually, Chai Ming-Liang becomes more of a fine artist in touch with museums than movie theaters. And we're just like, we can't cover installation art when we weren't there. We can't, you know, we can't cover his sculptures or his paintings or his plays because we just have no way of seeing any of that. So we are mostly going to focus on his movies. But it's important to know that the career of Chai Ming-Liang slowly steps away from narrative theatrical cinema and towards something more avant-garde and quote-unquote fine art. They represent a large enough portion of his filmography that I thought they should be mentioned. Chai spent the 90s establishing his reputation on an international stage, emerging with a clear voice, a unique style, and an escalating sense of ambition. And in 2001, he would springboard into what many consider his masterpiece, What Time Is It There? What Time Is It There is another one of the movies that features Li Kangsheng as Xiao Kang and features Liu Yiqing as his mother and Miao Tian as his father. They live in the same apartment they lived in The River and in Rebels of the Neon God. In this film, after the first scene, Miao Tian dies and his ashes are taken to a columbarium. And it is about the grief that Xiao Kang and his mother go through over the father's death, and particularly how that mutates into something stranger when Xiao Kang sells his father's watch to a young woman, Chiang Chi, who is going to go to France and wants the watch because it is able to tell two times at once so she can have both French and Taiwanese time on her wrist at all times. This morning... starts taking stranger and stranger shapes as Xiao Kang becomes obsessed with France and starts running around the city of Taipei, changing all of the clocks to French time. Meanwhile, the mother thinks that the father's soul has been reincarnated in their pet fish. So she starts also experiencing grief in strange ways. Xiang Qi feels displacement as she lives in France and realizes that she can't connect to anyone there and sort of faces culture shock from how different France is to Taiwan. I think an important thing to know about What Time Is It There is it really does, to me, feel like a culmination of the previous three films because, like we said, Rebels of the Neon God, kind of outside of most of his work in terms of how conventional it is, in terms of how much dialogue there is, camera movement, emotions stated. Each subsequent film after Rebels of the Neon God would add something into Chai Ming-Liang's tool belt that plays into What Time Is It There. Vive L'Amour is a movie that is it's a difficult movie because at any given point, it is very hard to say what any character is thinking or why they are doing what they are doing, which you might think is just like that's foundational how you tell a story. But there's more than one way to tell a story. And Chiming Liang tends to tell stories where you do not get an interview into the psychology of a character, or rather you are invited to reflect on what that inner life might be. But you almost never get direct information about how they're feeling or what they're doing or why. And Vive L'Amour is the first movie that really embraces that. The River is a movie that is more ambitious visually, because Vive L'Amour and Rebels of the Young God both have a very objective camera. They're both shot on location, and they both mostly use lighting that is meant to appear natural. Obviously, it's a feature film. There's always lights and stuff, but none of the lighting seems particularly expressive. In The River, there's several sequences that are bathed in shadow. A lot of sequences take place in bathhouses, and those bathhouses are sort of strange, surreal, nightmarish places with super dark shadow and just like light highlights on bodies. The lighting in The River is a thing that visually he had never attempted before, and it feels more ambitious than the previous films in that way. The Hole is a movie, like I said, I mentioned the musical numbers. The Hole is where he sort of introduces elements of surrealism, like out-and-out surrealism into his films. He introduces the world that you're seeing is not the what we may necessarily think of the real world. He opens up the ability to tell a story that exists more in the internal world or the spiritual world, which is relevant in What Time Is It There, because at the end of the film, Miao Tian comes back as a ghost, and there's no other interpretation. It's there are ghosts in this film. There are ghosts in the next film we're going to be talking about, Goodbye Dragon Inn, as well. And that would continue. There was much less dedication to a realistic, objective, documentary kind of point of view of the camera. All of these things come together into What Time Is It There, which in some ways is like extremely similar to Vive L'Amour. It is these, or The River, it is these stories of these people who are all in each other's lives but are not communicating well to each other, who are all going through things in isolation, in crowded urban environments. The sort of dichotomy between the loneliness they feel and the just masses of people and bodies that are in any given shot of the movie traveling in the background or whatever is one of the like pointed visual motifs. I absolutely adore What Time Is It There. Bill, how do you feel about What Time Is It There?
I love it, but it's one, like I said, when I first saw it, having no context for what he does, I found it interesting but hard to totally approach it. I mean, I hadn't seen anything like it at the time. And I think now, I think it's funny in that it sets you up for a romantic film that it's like you have the meet cute, and now he's doing that quirky thing where he's changing all the clocks to like, you know, like align with the time where she is, but they never meet again. And for the rest of the film, like it sets you up for a certain kind of story that it doesn't aim to pay off that way. Like it's just they've had that interaction, and maybe they'll meet in other Simon Lang films, but they won't meet again at the end of this one. It's just they're going to have their parallel kind of narratives, but it also is funny to me watching it again in that it points towards Goodbye Dragon Inn, right down to him going to that same theater and having his own kind of run-in with the cruising culture of that theater. Like it feels like it's pointing towards, what is that short film, The Skywalk Is Gone, with the characters, like those characters come back again in Wayward Cloud. Like those protagonists, the story's not ending with this film for those characters. And the parents feel like the parents from Rebels of the Neon God. Like there's so much that kind of connects it to other films. But if you don't have that context, it's not quite as rich as it is if you have that context, which is what I think about when I think about like the rapturous responses that a film is demanding as Days will get. It's because it's being reviewed by people that have that grounding and that history oftentimes with what he does. And so they're bringing things to it that someone coming in off the street might not have that same set of tools to
to unpack it, I guess. Does that make sense? I mean, do you agree with me there?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I think the most astounding thing about Chai Ming-Liang's body of work is that he keeps hitting these same notes over and over again, and yet every film has such a distinct identity, and every film feels like an incomplete part of this larger puzzle. The fact that the ending of this film is not a conclusion of anything involving Li Kangsheng's character or Chen Xiangqi's character or Lu Yiqing's character. All of their narratives are left unsatisfied. They are in the same state they are at the beginning, where they are displaced and mourning, and they don't. It doesn't feel like any of them have learned anything. They're static characters. The ending of What Time Is It There is a conclusion to is Miao Tian's character, the dead father. You know, you see him in France somehow, and he sort of walks off into the horizon, you know, John Wayne in The Searcher style. You just sort of assume, like, and you know, he goes out into the clouds, or he goes into the afterlife or whatever. But the fact that you have all of this open ended, and you don't get the ending, you don't get the ending of these characters. And then also in the sequel, Wayward Cloud, we do not see Lu Yiqing, Xiao Kang's mother. We're going to assume that these are the same characters in all these movies that have the same same names, we don't get Xiao's mother's end until Visage in 2009. And it's definitely a body of work that it does work like not a puzzle in that it's like, ah, this is the key. When David Lynch put this key, blue key here, that meant this and this and that. You know, like it's not a YouTube explainer sort of a thing. It's like once you see them all, then you get it. There are emotional resonances throughout that just sort of intensify and amplify. So it's definitely like I liked it just because I like this. I adore Chai Ming-Liang because I adore Chai Ming-Liang's sensibilities. Like I just think his aesthetic taste.
Yeah.
The first time I saw this movie, I liked it because A, it kind of felt like Rebels of the Neon God, but B, it's beautiful. The colored lighting throughout this movie is just absolutely gorgeous. This is the one I emailed you. I was reading a book about slow cinema and Chai Ming-Liang's place in it, and someone in that book built a diagram that was like, here's the number of shots in every movie, here's how long each movie is, here's the average length of each shot, and here's how many of those shots move and versus are static shots. And What Time Is It There is the only film of his that has no moving camera whatsoever. It's completely static throughout, and that was a choice by Chai Ming-Liang. He's working with a French cinematographer in this film, and together they were saying, well, you know, it's sort of like a byproduct of filmmaking is you have your day where you have to get these many setups and these many shots. And the more setups and shots you need to get, the less you can pay attention to any one shot. If you're shooting coverage, that's why you get to, you know, films that have a lot of handheld coverage. There's not a single look. There's not a single image in the movie that looks that good or interesting or distinct on its own, because the effect is about the montage of all the angles together. No one, you know, really sculpted this one composition. This movie is all perfectly sculpted compositions, and the highlights and the shadows and the colored lighting in the house where they have the red light bulb, but you have the blue light from the fish tank, and the green color of the apartment and the movie theater, the dark of the movie theater, and the like everything about this movie is just so gorgeous that I was rapturous about it on pure like surface level. It means so much more to me now that I've seen it all as part of body work. But like, I always love this movie just because it is just like so pretty.
Yeah, I think when you put it aside, the rest of them, it does not have maybe the transgressive elements of The River or Wayward Cloud or the musical numbers. It does not have like the things that feel like not the break with the rhythm, but that feel like. That jolt you out of the kind of serene storytelling that he's kind of getting into with this and with Goodbye Dragon. And like it feels like, I don't know what the word well-rounded is, you know, but it feels like if you graduated past Rebels of the Neon God, as far as like getting your feet wet with what he does, I think that this is probably the second most accessible film.
I would agree. I think there are definitely elements of The River that are very difficult to sit with. Not just the incestual content, but also just like the physical pain that comes with the neck illness, it can be very unpleasant to watch. And
yeah, I mean, the things that deal with, like, physical ailment, I mean, that's also in something that you have in Days and in I Don't Want to Sleep Alone. Like, there's none of that, and there's none of the, I don't know what to say about that other than it feels like, I feel like a million people have probably brought up how timely it is in the pandemic era. Like, it was very forward thinking in that kind of story, but it feels like not like a one joke movie, because it's got a lot of jokes, but like, it feels like there's a high concept comedic premise to it in a way that I don't feel like applies to a lot of his other movies. Like, his comedy is a little bit more comedy of manners, maybe, in most of the other ones, and this one feels like there's a visual gag, and it's like it could be a Laurel and Hardy kind of concept.
Yeah. Well, Roger Ebert, there's the one shot where you see the giant clock on the outside of the building, and you see him reaching down with a broom or a long stick or something to change the hands on the giant clock. Roger Ebert said that was safety last.
Safety last, I guess that would be. Yeah, yeah. Him with the clock was the first image I saw from one of his movies. I remember that being a still that was circulating for that movie, and I thought, like, what could it be? I assumed it wasn't like a reference to Flavor Flav. I just didn't know what the idea was.
Yeah, or the guy who comes on to him in that bathroom, which we will see again later in Goodbye Dragon, and bursts open the door, and he has the clock over his dick, and the clock hand is like very suggestively twitching. Like, that's all physical visual humor in a way that sits outside of the funny elements of Aviv L'Amour.
And that kind of stuff, I mean, is when, I mean, it opens with a quite long, unbroken shot of the father that is probably one of the only times it feels like, oh, this is slow cinema. But it really does not stay in that register for very long. I feel like there is a lot of comedy to it. This is an odd question, maybe, but I it doesn't totally apply to this particular film, which is not, well, I guess it is kind of sexual in places, but I was thinking about how there's a lot of either like rough sexuality or forced sexuality or like just unpleasant sexuality in the films that seems to go back even to like the like even some of the TV work. But like, just like the, but even we talk about things like Rebels of the Neon God and like the slightly violent, maybe closeted character. Like, there's, and we get to something like Wayward Cloud. And I remember when Rosenbaum trashed it, and Rosenbaum was a big champion of most of his other films, but he said, at least in that film, that he felt like the director hated the sexuality of it or hated the sex of it. What do you think about that side of it? I mean, as far as like, these are films that either seem to be about rejection or degradation, or like not always. I mean, there's healthy sexuality in it too, but I feel like there's also a lot of darker currents swimming through a lot of it. And I don't know if that's something that you notice watching them all in together. I mean, I certainly think of moments like Stray Dogs. I think about, like, I mean, the standout scene for me is a scene that really kind of unleashes this like really hidden, frightening side of the character, with a head of lettuce, you know, or cabbage or whatever to like take it out on. But that there's a lot of pent up sexual violence in the films that I think also kind of give it like a tension that I don't associate with quote unquote slow cinema.
No, it's true. Sex is really important to the work of Chai Ming-Liang, and I find that in his work, sex is something that people, they can't help it. They need it. It's sort of a basic fundamental need or whatever. But sex is something that people try to use to fix something that sex can't fix. So in the sort of worldview of Chai Ming-Liang, sex is inherently dissatisfying in some way because it is a sort of replacement for something deeper that can't be addressed. And I feel like a lot of that rejection and anxiety, and there's a sense of like self-loathing when you look at like Lee Kang Shang and Viv L'Amour, who's masturbating under the bed that the other two characters are having sex in. The river, the sex scenes in the river, even the ones outside of the incestual sex act that appears at the climax of that movie, they feel unsatisfying, and they feature people sort of sitting in the dark for a long time afterwards. There's no sense of contentment or peace after the sex act. There's no like afterglow or pillow talk or anything like that. Sex is used as a way to explore the basic emotional needs of people that aren't being met. And I do think you can, he pushes that in Wayward Cloud to the, all the way to the point where I think that is like a sex negative film. I think that is a film where in the world of Wayward Cloud, there is a drought, but for some reason there are so many watermelons. Watermelons are so plentiful that people are using watermelon juice in place of all of the uses they would normally use water. So it's like people have built an entire culture around watermelons. People have built like, oh yeah, if you're courting someone, you can give people different colored watermelons based on, you know, if you're a student, you know, these kids are giving each other different watermelons based on how they feel. And like people are drinking glasses of watermelon juice and people are bathing in watermelon and water is this like precious resource that the first time that Xiang-Chi and Xiao-Chang Kang see each other again, it is because she steals his water bottle. He's fallen asleep on a public bench and she steals his water bottle to get his water and only afterwards realizes, like, starts to feel bad because she realizes, hey, this is the guy who sold me that watch all those years ago. To me, Wayward Cloud is a movie about pornography specifically being like this like very unhealthy, sugary replacement for a basic element that we all need as human beings to survive, but we're instead feeding ourselves something that doesn't really quite address it. Like we're all masturbating to pornography and that's not actually emotional connections, and in fact that's making it harder to connect to people emotionally. And that movie has an extremely disgusting, vulgar, violent sexuality at the end when the Japanese porn actress is found in an elevator either comatose or dead. The movie doesn't really bother to distinguish between the two, and it's equally disgusting either way. These pornographers sort of just drag her body back to a bed and start making a movie with her lifeless body, and like it's just like a really ugly scene that is sort of the payoff of what the entire rest of the movie was about, which is people build these sexualities around pornography, which I think he is anti-porn. I think that movie is very anti-porn, which is not my personal feel. I think pornography is complicated, but I think there's a lot of very valid uses and artistic, you know, validity to pornography in a lot of contexts or whatever. But I believe that Chai Ming-Liang's very anti-porn, and he views that kind of casual sexuality as being an insufficient replacement for what people actually need. And I think in this movie, like, you get Xiao Kang, you know, getting propositioned by a woman. She's either a hooker or she's just sort of a woman on the street, but either way, she just out and out, he's sleeping in the back of his car and she's like, you want to fuck? And they have sex, but it is immediately followed by him getting robbed by her walking off with his suitcase full of watches. It is this, like, you cannot trust the sexual act. The sexual act will ultimately leave you in a worse position than you were before. I think that is generally true across most of his work. But also, it's not a scold. It's not a moralistic, like, you should be chaste either. I think one of the most moving images in any of his work is in I Don't Want to Sleep Alone, when the young couple, the waitress, who is also sort of this maid and caretaker for the woman who owns the cafe, and she takes care of that woman's comatose son. She falls in love with Li Kang Sheng's character. And there is a scene where there's some sort of, this is again another sort of pandemic in imagery that pops up a lot in these movies, where there was some sort of underground fire that has put the entire city of Bangkok in smoke. And they are wearing gas masks, improvised gas masks. Again, like in a post-COVID world, the idea of someone like rubber banding a fucking empty instant ramen noodle bowl to their face as like a gas mask is like, yeah, I was there. I was there in April 2020 when people were just like wearing bandanas around their faces and shit. That seems very funny, but like there's a sequence in that where they're trying to make love in this abandoned building and they're surrounded by smoke and they're trying to kiss each other, but they're both wearing gas masks and they're sort of just smashing their mask into each other, and they'll try to pull up the gas mask and start kissing, but then they start gagging and coughing, so they'll put the mask back on and they're desperately trying to make it work. And it is, that to me is like one of the most powerful images in any of his movies, because it is to me this, like, the world is this horrible, hostile place where there's so much suffering and so many things are going wrong, and the one thing that you can do to sort of shut out how bad the world can get is to fuck. And like, these are two characters who are trying to, you know, forget about how hard their lives are and how despondent they are and how terrible the positions in this world are, like, you know, financially. That is a movie that is very concerned with gentrification and homelessness and these sort of migrant workers. This, and like, Chai Ming-Liang 100% understands the inclination to sex, and he understands the importance of that sex to these two characters and why they are doing it. He doesn't sort of object to it on moralist, these people aren't married and don't know each other well enough. I think he finds casual sex to be largely insufficient. But also that given the way he has talked about his own sexuality, his own sex life, and the story that I read about, you know, Li Kangsheng waiting outside of a bathhouse as, you know, Tsai Ming-Liang does what he needs to do. Like, that's also the world he lives in.
Yeah.
So I find sex in his movies very important and very fascinating and complicated. But I do think ultimately he is not a very sex positive person.
No, it was this thing I was thinking about, like, over the course of the films, like, they often link sexuality with some kind of negative repercussions, not always as extreme as The River. And, you know, that's, I like plenty of films that do that. You know, it's just kind of something I noticed that I was wondering if that was something that reflected him as a person, like, dealing with, like, a hostile culture to his sexuality and like being in love with somebody that couldn't quite reciprocate to all the needs that he has. And so it's like being he's channeling those feelings into art. But I, you know, not trying to get too psychoanalytic with, like, I really don't know. It's just something I noticed as far as like a recurring theme or motif in the work. But
there are certain artists whose work is so personal that, like, whatever boundaries you try to set up in terms of, like, you know, biography is not destiny, you don't, you know, the facts of someone's life is not always the core reason why they make any given artistic choice or anything like that. Like, you still have to operate in that space a little bit to understand it, and that is definitely how I understand the role of sex in his movies. I also think the role of sex in his movies is part of why I find his work so much more approachable than a lot of other slow cinema, which is that he just has a very earthy approach to his art. His films don't feel austere in that they are, like, very high-minded. I watched Nostalgia recently, and Nostalgia is a movie that I am just absolutely enraptured with and I adore. And then someone starts talking and I go, oh, fuck, it's the poetry again. and I just can't do it. And that's not like, oh, and Tarkovsky's worse off for it. It's just like, that's why Tarkovsky doesn't connect to me the same way. Yeah. I think another thing that makes Chai Ming-Liang's work very earthy and approachable is the scatological element, which is that you will see in his body of work, Li Kangsheng do emit every single bodily fluid. You will, the very first scene of Rebels of the Neon God, he cuts his hand on a window and starts bleeding. But you're going to see him puke. You're going to see him piss. In this movie, he's afraid to go to the bathroom because he thinks his father is sort of haunting the hallway. And so he is constantly peeing in bottles and plastic bags and stuff all. And you just, like, get to watch him for hysterically, like, 2 straight minutes, just fill a plastic bag with his piss. And, like, you will watch a lot of people go to the bathroom in all of these movies. There's so much pissing and shitting in the world of Chai Ming-Liang. But there's puking in the hole. He pukes down the hole. There's, there's ejaculate in Wayward Cloud. There's a very, like, graphic scene of him ejaculating. There's just so much that he is really obsessed with the body. Yeah. And he is obsessed with all the body's functions, and he is obsessed with tying these characters to the real world and their real surroundings. And part of that is, like, shooting in real locations and using these long shots that emphasize environments and all that. But then part of that is this, like, scatological element to these movies.
I always took that as, like, his obsession with Li Kangsheng was so absolute that he had to explore the body, had to explore the bodily fluids, had to explore all of it somewhere over the course of those decades of collaboration. But I
think totally, like, when you have a film that is so austere and so minimalistic the way that so many of these films are, tone is everything, because what you're doing with setting tone is you are creating the space for the for the people who are watching, for their mind to wander, and you are pointing the direction for where their mind is wandering and the things they're feeling, because you're not doing it through very explicit manipulative kind of means. You're not doing it through the score comes in when they're supposed to be sad. Even austere film, you know, slow paced filmmakers from Taiwan like Hao Shei Shen, a lot of his films have like very sentimental music cues. Hao Shei Shen is not afraid to tell you how to feel, but Chai Ming-Liang's not going to do that. He's going to set tone, and I think the way he uses the body, part of that is definitely just an obsession. Like, you see so much of Li Kangsheng's body in this, and it's like the way he shoots it. It's like you see him in all the best angles. You're like, yeah, that dude has a nice body. Like, again, he does not have Tony Leung matinee idol movie star like Hong Kong pop star looks, but like when you see him in his tidy whiteies in Vive L'Amour lying down in profile, you're gonna go, okay, yeah, this dude knows. But I think that that is such like a big part of these movies. Another thing I want to talk about with What Time Is It There is this idea of like this movie, because so much of it takes place in public, and this is not just What Time Is It There, this is so many of his films. There's this sense of liminal spaces. There's this sense of blurring of the lines between public and private spaces, the idea of rented spaces, the idea of people using spaces that they're not for reasons they're not supposed to use. Obviously, Goodbye Dragon In, the fact that you know, second run movie theater becomes a cruising spot is a good example of that. And that same second run movie theater is a cruising spot in this film. But like, there are so many scenes of people just sort of like hanging out in hallways or like sitting on railings, the skywalk in this movie. There's just so many emphasis on hallways and elevators and back rooms and stuff like that throughout Tsai Ming-Liang's work that I think there is a political angle to his work. I think he is someone who he doesn't deal with it in explicit ways. He doesn't. I feel the first time I saw Stray Dogs, I thought he was. I thought, you know, again, almost all of his movies, the first time I see them, I only get the surface level. And the first time I saw Stray Dogs, I was like, oh, this is Roger Ebert empathy machine. Isn't it hard to be homeless? Mm-hmm. And I think Stray Dogs is actually about something else, and we will get there. But like, generally speaking, I think Chai Ming-Liang is someone who is very skeptical about sort of modernization and about gentrification and about the idea of like a city, like a economic boom benefiting the people who live in a city, and the idea of, generally speaking, everyone is always out to sell something. Every place you go exists so you can buy it. Every space where people find any kind of solace and peace, they did because they have paid money to be there. That is something that I just find inexorably linked to the work of Chai Ming-Liang, is that anxiety about capital and global capital. In this case, like this is a movie that takes place both in France and Taiwan, and is examining how much of a global village do we actually live in? Like, how much is globalization a good thing, and how much can we really consider ourselves all part of the same world? That this is one of those things that I feel much stronger than I'm able to articulate. But
I dropped my only economics class, just like, you know, the character in Ripple, that, you know, Rebels of the Young God. Like, I dropped the one class that I probably should have taken. But like, I would say that, yeah, you can feel the economic anxiety in almost every one of these films, unless they're dealing with bodily anxiety. Like, those are the only two kind of anxieties you really have. I mean, there's obviously the romantic. But I think that, yeah, I mean, you go back to the TV movies, you know, like All the Corners of the World is about like the family of scalpers, you know, and Boys is about like, you know, one teenager shaking down another younger boy, you know, and Rebels of the Neon God, it's like, you know, if you don't go to school, you can't make money. All through, I mean, Viva L'Amour like is dealing with money, and Wayward Cloud is dealing with like the economic realities of pornography, and Stray Dogs, you know, and What Time Is It There, like, you know, it's like selling products, or, you know, advertising in the streets, like, you know, even in the conditions that are unpleasant. It's not like a cinema of
privileged characters and like their kind of anxieties. Like, it's not like Antonioni, you know, it's not like anything that comes from that tradition or the, you know, the comedy of the idle rich. Like, it's not like screwball comedies of the 30s that way. Like, it's like these are characters that have to work for a living in almost every case. And it's like only in cases like Days that you're not focusing on money, but then you're just focusing on the body. I guess there's a little bit of an economic reality there in that the hustler is still kind of out on the streets at the end of that story. That's a whole other conversation. But like the, economic reality is definitely something that is a factor in pretty much everyone that we've talked about, everyone I can think of. I mean,
and even as a, I think there's also like a sort of alternate parallel reading of his body of work where he is talking about the film industry throughout all of these movies. Obviously, Visage, it's very pointed, but like Wayward Cloud, it's obvious too. But like when you are talking about What Time Is It There, it's impossible to look at What Time Is It There and not see that as being inspired by when you look at Xiangqi's story. It's impossible not to see that as being inspired by what Ming-Liang felt being in France. Where, you know, he's being heralded as this genius and meeting all these people who in his own home country would never, you know, acknowledge his work the same way, outside of maybe other filmmakers. But like he just doesn't have that. And he is, and the when you're talking about like economic anxiety, Ming-Liang is someone who is constantly hustling. The buskers and the street salesmen and the sort of unregulated marketplaces of blankets with stolen clothing that exist in Vive L'Amour. All these things, these are the real world that Ming-Liang lives in, because one of the most fascinating things about him as an artist is that when he makes movies, that when they show in Taiwan, the way they show in Taiwan, he owns the copyright on them. He doesn't work with a distributor or anything. He four walls a movie theater. He rents out a movie theater. And he goes out on the street and he runs people down and sells tickets. That is literally how he still makes movies. Days, his most recent feature film, he was out on the street selling tickets. And at this point, he's sort of a local character. People know him by his bald head and people know what they're in for. What Time Is It There? He shot the scene in this movie theater. And he showed it in Taiwan in this movie theater. And it was a 1,500-seat theater. And he sold 1,500 seats, and the owner of the theater said, "It's been 20 years since we sold out a showing. What is your secret? Can you please like be the manager? Can you run this?" And he goes, No, you don't understand. I did this like it's not that I'm I had a great marketing campaign. I just hustled my ass off to get people to see my movie." And then the guy who owned the theater went, "Well, we're going to shut down in 2 weeks if you don't, you know, do something." So he goes, "All right, I'll lease the theater from you." And Goodbye Dragon Inn apparently came a year after he said that. Because he'd forgotten that he had leased out this theater. And then someone at his company was like, "Hey, are you ever going to do anything with this theater that we've been paying rent on for 11 months? And he goes, "Oh, I guess I'll make a movie there." But like the idea of the person who is like has to hustle to make a living and has to constantly find new angles to get money coming in. That's Ming-Liang's world. As he stepped away from theatrical film exhibition, he eventually started using his brand to like convince museums to give him money or for film festivals to commission works from him. But also he took over the coffee shop that Lu Yiqing, who plays Xiao Kang's mother in all these movies, she quit working at the coffee shop and he was like, "All right, I'll take it over." And because he is Ming-Liang, the winner of the Golden Horse and the Golden Bear and all these things, he was eventually able to get a museum to like buy his coffee from him, and he supplies the coffee to that museum, and he was able to like dovetail that into like, "Okay, well, I've been painting chairs lately. Will you buy some paintings of my chairs? And I'm going to do some other works." And it's like, he did a lecture about the last 10 years of his career. He goes, "I know that most of you know the first 10 years of my career. This is what I've been up to the last most recent 10 years of my career." And he tells these stories. He doesn't talk about them as far as like, "This is why artistically I was drawn to this aesthetic," or like, "I realized that the way to better purely express myself with this." He talks about them like they're scams that he got away with. Like, he has this little glint in his eye. And when you read interviews with him, they often reference that he has like this mischievous look about him, like a trickster monk. and like So he is that hustler. Like, that is his life.
Yeah, I just always assume that most filmmaker, most auteur directors that stay in the game for decades have a little bit of that spirit. It maybe not to the extent that he does, but I as far as that kind of hustler sensibility, because it is a competitive world to thrive in. And I think about, like, someone that makes proudly, like, he's not making concessions to any kind of commercial marketplace. So how do you survive, you know, financially in doing films like this? And I think, you know, a lot of people teach, or they do commercial work, or they do things, you know, on the side to support the feature film career, unless they are like a very small minority of directors that just make tons of money from directing films. I don't think he is one of them, but yeah, I think that embrace of the institutional world, you know, and the gallery culture and things like that. I mean, that makes so much sense for what he does, to not have to compromise and still earn a good living doing it.
So in 2002, Tsai followed up What Time Is It There with its short film sequel with The Skywalk Is Gone, which is it sort of functions as a bridge. I intended the pun, and I think Tsai intends the pun as well, between What Time Is It There and its sequel, Wayward Cloud. But before we can even get to talking about Wayward Cloud, we have to talk about the next feature that he made, Goodbye Dragon Inn. Goodbye Dragon Inn. Okay, so something instantly right off the bat, when you tell the story of Goodbye Dragon Inn, every single movie website, every IMDb, Wikipedia, everything, whenever they give a synopsis of this movie, and this, for all I know, this could be from the artist statement from Tsai Ming-Liang himself, when it, you know, from a catalog when it played at a film festival, but they say this is the last night that the movie theater is open. There is nothing in the movie itself that says this is the last night the movie theater is open. It's just a vibe you get. So, like, the very fundamental premise of the movie is already a little ambiguous, but it's not necessarily one I disagree with. It does feel like the last night a movie theater is open. It opens with the movie theater in its heyday in the 60s, showing the King Q movie Dragon Inn, absolutely fantastic martial arts adventure film. The theater is packed. It's full of people who are rapt with attention, staring up at the screen. Two of the people in the theater we see is someone with a bald head and someone with long white hair. I've alternately seen this described as a child, Tsai Ming-Liang, sitting with his grandfather, as his grandparents are the ones who sort of instilled his love of movies, taking him to the movies multiple times a day. But also I've seen it written that there is a specific queer film critic from Taiwan who is actually the man sitting next to him, whose name I don't have in front of me at the moment. But at any rate, we flash forward to the present day, where it is now a sort of decrepit movie theater. It's mostly abandoned. Japanese tourist wanders in off the street. There's no one working the box office, so he just kind of helps himself into the movie already in progress. We follow the rhythms and the vibes of the movie theater, the people who frequent it. In this case, it is not patrons of movies, generally speaking. It is gay cruisers who are wandering around the back rooms and hallways and bathrooms of this giant movie palace, looking to score. And the two people who work at, the projectionist and the ticket woman, this disabled ticket woman who has a brace on her leg and walks with a very distinct limp, played by Chen Xiangqi. Li Kang Sheng is the one who plays the projectionist, not featured until the last 30 minutes or so of the movie. And you just sort of watch the movie theater. You watch people watch the movie, but you yourself are watching the movie theater. This is a movie that, the first time I saw it, I thought it was way too slow. There's not enough story. I thought parts of it were amusing and parts of it were beautiful, but ultimately it just didn't work. The Music Box Theater in Chicago had a, when they reopened in the pandemic, which I think happened early 2021, might have been late 2020. I think it was actually, yeah, like fall of 2020. When they reopened, they had a program of movies about movie theaters, or movies that are essential to be seen in movie theaters. And as part of that program, I saw on the same day Playtime by Jacques Tati for the first time on the big screen. Mm. And Goodbye Dragon Inn, which I had seen two or three times before, but never on the big screen. That was an insane double feature.
I was going to say, was Jonathan Rosenbaum programming for them that day?
Right. I saw Playtime first, mm-hmm. which is a very sad movie that that is nonetheless very funny. And that was the first Jacques Tati movie I ever saw. And then I immediately saw Goodbye Dragon Inn and went, and it was like this piece of the Chai Ming-Liang puzzle was missing. I go, oh, Jacques Tati, physical comedy, the wide shot, like the crushing nature of modernity, the anti-human setup of the modern city. Like that was absolutely mind-blowing. And Goodbye Dragon Inn instantly became like one of my all-time favorite movies. Watching this in a movie theater, hearing the echoing sounds of the film Dragon Inn, which is a movie I also love and has a very distinct score. So even if you don't know the dialogue word for word and you can't necessarily place where in the story they are from glimpses of the images, just hearing that music instantly, nostalgically, not necessarily nostalgically because I didn't watch it as a kid, but like I have fond memories of the film. So like I have a strong emotional warm fuzzies just hearing that soundtrack echoing off of the caverns of this movie palace. I am seeing it inside of a movie palace. The Music Box Theater was built in the 30s, and the echo, the notorious echo of its main theater is perhaps charming, but maybe mostly distracting when you're trying to figure out what people are saying in a screwball comedy or whatever if you're not sitting in the right seat. But at any rate, the act of watching a movie theater, and you're watching the movie theater as much as you're watching the people, It's very moving, and it's obviously like in the context of COVID, in the context of all these movie theaters are shutting down, it takes on a whole different dimension in the context of the film industry is collapsing and this is all falling apart. Like it's just so overwhelmingly moving, but also kind of difficult to talk about because there isn't much of a plot. I can really just like start naming shots I love. obviously the most Jacques Tati like out and out comedy sequence is the hilarious long take bathroom scene where this this seemingly abandoned theater has like 9 different men inside of this men's room, all none of whom are acknowledging each other, but all of whom are standing very close to each other, some of whom are peeing for like 5 straight minutes. Again, just more like out and out surrealism from Chai Ming-Liang. They're sort of making their moves, they're making their gestures, they're trying to figure out, you know, is so-and-so going to do it? And it's just over the course of the shot, more and more and more people fill this bathroom. Very hysterical. But like, I don't know, I fucking adore Goodbye Dragon Inn for the same reason so many people adore Goodbye Dragon Inn. Bill, how do you feel about Goodbye Dragon Inn?
I love it. I think I remember when you didn't like it on Letterboxd, and I think that's one of the only films I've reviewed on Letterboxd was that one. I think I did like it. I think at the time when I first saw it, I don't know if I would say this now, but I think I think I said something like it felt like an art gallery installation tribute to the Red River scene in Last Picture Show, you know, like the scene where they go to the movie theater the last night in town, and it just kind of like this kind of nostalgic thing, but it's not really doing that so much. It's not like it's The Long Day Closes or something. Like it's acknowledging, you know, the challenge of walking around the large space. It's acknowledging the audience hasn't really come out for the show. It's like, oh, it's sparsely attended and there's loud chewing behind you, and like even your cruising efforts can be kind of thwarted if you're not like lucky that night. Like it's not like it's seeing humor and not necessarily pathos, but it's like acknowledging a certain kind of imperfection to it all. But it is also still in love with movies and old movie palaces as well. Like and so I think cinephiles are always going to be the biggest audience for a film like this, because it is kind of a, you know, not like the magic of movies or something. Like it's not doing that, but it is kind of like, yeah, it is kind of like got a certain kind of like warm reverence for, you know, a kind of exhibition experience that is, you know, increasingly rare, even in the years since, when did that come out? 2003? Like it only, you know, is further and further away from us, that kind of experience. It's funny, I watching it again, I sometimes hear, like, you know, they make references to like, oh, the theater is haunted, and you know, sometimes people talk about the woman the woman like chewing loudly being a ghost, but I think when I watch it, I think Lee Kang Sheng is really the ghost of the film, because he doesn't show up for most of it, and it's like, it almost feels like a film about Tsai Ming-Liang waiting for him to show up so he can start making his movie. because at the time, Lee Kang Sheng was directing his own film, and so they had to start shooting without him being available for much of the shoot. So he only really kind of appears at the very end. But because he's the muse, it's just... It's a film about his absence. It's much shorter than all the other films. Even Rebels of the Neon God. Like, everything is longer than this. Even the TV movies are longer than this.
I honestly, because everyone's been in a movie theater, because it has the comedic side of it. Like, if I was going to expose just a layperson, a non-cinephile, to like a slow cinema sort of film, this would be like the most approachable one. And part of that is you can watch it and you can feel how long each shot is, and you can feel the lack of camera movement, but you're still like, you're only committing to like 89 minutes.
Not even. Is it even 80 minutes? It's short. I mean, for a feature film. I agree with you. I think this was the one where... I mean, I'd liked other films of his, but this is where it really kind of crystallized for me what he's, you know, what makes him great, even more than Rebels of the Neon God, which, you know, I liked, but I think, you know, I liked it even more on a rewatch. This one I appreciated right away, and I think to see it on a big screen would only kind of enhance it. But, I mean, I saw it on whatever DVD I think had come out for it, and now it actually has one of the nicer home video presentations through Second Run. But, like, even in, like, a... so-so DVD transfer, I could see how beautiful it was.
I was so moved the last time I watched it, and it was on my non-anamorphic Wellspring DVD. Like, it's not even taking up all of my tiny TV.
Yeah.
You don't need, it's not about bombast, and it's not about, like, tricking you into feeling the space necessarily by, like, oh, yeah, you have to see on the biggest screen possible, so you're really immersed in it. Like, it's not that kind of immersion.
No, but I think it would be... I don't know. I'd like to experience. I've never seen any of his films in a theater. So I don't know how that would. And I know that a few people have made claims for it, like being, yeah. I feel like every film benefits from that. I mean, even the films that are like My Dinner with Andre type films. You know, I think every film benefits from that personally.
Oh yeah.
I think this one. It's funny to see this one taking the lead past some of the other films in those kind of polls. It always strikes me as interesting when a different film becomes that film. Like, I mean, I remember finding it strange when Mulholland Drive overtook Eraserhead and Blue Velvet on those kind of lists for Lynch. And I see, you know, it's going to be the same way if a different film overtakes Do the Right Thing for Spike Lee, or... You know, if some other film overtakes Raging Bull and Taxi Driver for Scorsese, like if Goodfellas becomes that film, which is entirely possible, you know. So I don't know. This one, because it's dealing with cinema themes, I feel like it's like Vertigo in that way, and that like it's, you know, critics push this thing. I don't know if you put all these films in front of an audience that this would be the popular favorite with some of the other ones that are like... have broader comedy or like, you know, like that are like a little bit more accessible. Like, I think What Time Is It There is a more accessible film for a lay person. But I agree with you that if you're trying to understand slow cinema, this is one of the best entryway points, and that is legitimately like, I mean, this is where the style that he only seems to push further with things like Stray Dogs and Days, like this feels like its most approachable iteration of that mature style to me.
Well, something that's really striking about this movie that I don't think I really noticed before the most recent time I saw it is that it actually, despite the fact that it doesn't necessarily have like a traditional plot, it is like really strongly logically driven in that, like the very first shot you see outside the theater, one of the you know, the color balance of everything is just like you see the red chairs in the lobby. And then every subsequent shot you see like way in the distance out of focus, like a little stripe of red. You know it's those chairs, and therefore your brain builds out the geography. There is this sense of, because it is so slow paced and because it's holding on these shots so long, you are able to, as a viewer, even if you're not a particularly like super observant, I'm picking out every, you know, little theme and detail and hidden message in every movie the first time I see it. Like, even if you have the time to absorb all of the information, and the way the information is laid out shot by shot, moment by moment, because it is all tied into the running time of Dragon Inn, which is, it's a longer movie. The movie itself, you were right, it's not 89 minutes, it's 81 minutes. This is a movie that's like, I think, 40 minutes shorter than King Hugh's film. But like, you know that it starts at the start because you hear the fanfare of the studio credits and you hear the narration setting up the plot. Dragon Inn has that sort of Michael Curtiz thing where it just opens by telling you sort of the state of the world before you get to the genre story. And you know that it's going to end with the end of the movie. And so I think he is sort of, he is forced to tell a very logical start to finish story in whatever form that story takes, in a way that his other films are so much more enigmatic, and they're so much more like, I don't know what's going to happen next, and I don't know why this happened. And like, even when you're in a scene, you go, I don't know why this happened next from the last scene. I don't know why this character decided to make this choice or move in this direction or all that. Like, so many of his movies are so enigmatic in this way. And in this one, it really feels like as soon as you get the feeling that there's like some sort of cruising or whatever, all the Japanese tourist makes sense, and you understand why he's doing what he's doing. And if the old men are the only people in the movie who are like very focused on the screen, and you get a payoff to that, you find out why. Even if you don't recognize the actors, you will eventually learn that they were the two actors in the movie. They're one of the most emotionally direct scenes in any of his work is the ticket woman with the disability sneaking behind the screen and looking up and seeing the super heroine, the actor from Dragon Inn, who was like one of the first female martial arts stars of the 60s. You see her like doing her wild wuxia like fight scenes and everything. And it's like, that right there is the Nicole Kidman AMC, everyone, the power of movies, like the most broadest possible, like, this is why we go to, like, literally, this is why we go to see Spider-Man. This is not, like, he's not making a movie about why we go see 400 Blows. He's not making a movie about why we go to see Mouchette or a Bresson film or something like challenging like that, or a Hao Shen or whatever. He's making a movie about Dragon Inn. And he's making a movie about, we down here in our pathetic lives cannot reach the heights that these martial arts stars can. But we transport to the screen. There's a moment of cross cutting that's like rapid cutting. It's the only time it ever happens in his entire filmography, rapid cutting, where you get her face and then you get the screen and you get the face in the screen and you get this like sense of transference of like she's leaving her body and entering the screen and she is the one flying there fighting. Like, it is so open emotionally in a way that he doesn't allow his movies to be generally. And I'm talking as a person who is a cinephile and who didn't like it the first time, so I might be a little hypocritical in saying this is super approachable and anyone can watch it and enjoy it. Again, like I have Chiming Liang brain poisoning. I can't speak for the average person.
It's interesting I can see that reading of that moment where she's being moved by that. I was also, just when I saw it, thinking, like, her, maybe a sense of envy, you know, that like her body is like presents her all these challenges, and here's a woman who's you know, able to achieve these Herculean kind of like fight kind of moves, and just kind of like that contrast, like, I thought something maybe like slightly bittersweet was being expressed in that moment as well, beyond just the pleasures of cinema, but also just kind of like that disconnect between bodies.
That, I mean, that's 100% there too as well. Absolutely. And it's, and like the story between the ticket woman and the projectionist, with neither character speaking a single word, is like maybe also the one of the most powerful examples of romantic longing in Chiming Liang's career. The long walk that she takes to the projection booth where he is not. He has already switched the reel and he's gone for a smoke break or whatever the hell he's doing. He doesn't care.
Yeah.
There is such a long pause where she is trying to decide whether or not she's going to leave that bun. And like, once you've seen the movie a couple times and you know where everything goes and you know, like, you don't even know that there is a projectionist that's supposed to be there. Like, you obviously, you know how a movie theater works, but like, you don't know their relationship or anything. He doesn't appear on screen at all. There's no dialogue about like, oh, she's in love with the projectionist. But like, once you actually know the emotions of that, that are at play here, the subtext, the pause that she has is 100%. Don't put yourself out there. You're going to look like an idiot. He doesn't fucking want you. You're not worth loving. Like that little internal monologue that we all have in our head at some point where we like have to take that risk and put ourselves out there. And when she takes that bun back, starts walking away, and then she does leave the bun for him and he does find it. But when he rides off on his motorcycle, she gets there like just 5 seconds too late for him to see her. But she gets there like soon enough to watch him drive away. Like that's the entire, like every single thing that happens between the two of them in this movie is she makes a laborious trip to the projection booth. He isn't there. She thinks about leaving him the bun. She thinks better of it. She walks back as she's packing up, presumably for good because the movie theater's closing. She leaves him the bun. He finds it. He takes it and drives away. She watches him drive away. They don't say anything. Like, oh, it is so, it just rips your heart. Like, that has nothing to do with the power of, like, I mean, it does have something to do with the power of cinema and that it's great fucking cinema, but it's like, it's not, it's, yeah. It's this totally separate other thing going on. So the bitterness and the pain and the longing, the unfulfilled longing of all of his other films is certainly here too. But at the very least, there's a clarity to her watching herself on screen that there isn't to, like, Lee Kang Shang bowling with a melon. in Vive L'Amour or something like that.
Yeah, well, I just wanted to point out, is it Chao Zheng, the actor from Rebels of the Neon God, Azi? He shows up as the handsome guy that the Japanese tourist tries hardest to make a pass at in the theater. And I always thought that was kind of like, I don't know if that's meant to be a callback to Rebels of the Neon God. I know he's in other films as well, but I mean, just like his being the unattainable object of desire for, you know, I don't know if that's the kind of character that, you know, that Lee Kang Shen would have played, you know, in another iteration of it, like that kind of, like the...
Well,
that's
always the Chen Chao Zheng role, is the, like, object of desire. And obviously, Chai Ming-Liang desires Lee Kang Shang, but he has Lee Kang Shang. He has a relationship with him. They're close friends. They're something more that is somewhat undefinable. Like, Chen Chao Zheng is, like, this unattainable thing where he is the handsome guy that the father picks up in the river, and he is the man on the... He's the Chinese man on the subway in What Time Is It There that she sees, and they just have this look. They have this sort of unspoken bond, and then before you know it, he's on the subway. And he drives away. Like, that's him throughout. I forget. He is in Visage, and I can't recall... I can't recall what his role in Visage is. I think he might just be working on the crew. This might break the unified theory of Chen Chao Zheng in Chai Ming-Liang movies. But that's funny. I saw that he was in Goodbye Dragon Inn, and I could not figure out who he was because I just like. It's this problem when you're watching movies that don't have many close-ups and that don't have a lot of dialogue where you hear people's voices, is sometimes it can be hard to tell who's who when you go on IMDb later and you see a bunch of names in a language you're not familiar with.
Yeah, well, I'll just say with IMDb and this guy, you know, the TV movies don't even bother to have accurate or even credits at all. I mean, it's
that's true.
It's funny how like even for a major director, and these films are like out there, that he does not have the kind of fan base that like meticulously corrects IMDb to give everyone credit. There's a lot of errors and like files that don't kind of like map correctly on that site. And as far as like some people can have two or three different pages because they just haven't mapped it all correctly together, or they put the same credits for two different people on the same. There's a lot of mistakes on there, unfortunately. But yeah, sure. I was surprised when I was looking up the early films like Boys this morning. The credits are not filled completed, you know, on there, and it's just wild because that's a major filmmaker, and those films are available. So you'd think that that would be completed. I mean, they don't have to necessarily point out uncredited people, but they don't even put the credits for who is in it, and they have the wrong credits for the first film, because I remember you told me before I even watched it that Lee, they have, what is it, like Lee Kang-sheng as the little boy in it, and he's like, he was a grown man when they made that movie.
Yeah. All the Corners of the World does not, in fact, feature Lee Kang-sheng, despite what IMDb says.
Yeah.
Another thing about Goodbye Dragon Inn, I think this is certainly pointed with Goodbye Dragon Inn, but I think there are a couple films by Chai Ming-Liang that have sort of been reconsidered in the era of COVID. I think part of it is because I started seriously exploring his work during lockdown in 2020. But just the influence his movies have had on me and how I think about, like, I live in an urban place, and the way I think about these spaces and how I exist in them, it's just been fundamentally altered by his work, and the way I think about the urban places and the cities I live in have been fundamentally altered by COVID in a way that are just sort of entwined and messy. But I tend to think of Chai Ming-Liang as like this COVID auteur, which is funny because his last movie, Days, it came out in 2020, but it was shot in 2019. Mm-hmm. So he is not a COVID auteur in the way that many others were, who were out there making movies. You know, the director of Host on Shudder is a much more of a COVID auteur in a literal sense. But when I think about the primary concerns and anxieties and themes of his work, I just think of things that have become so much more vivid and large and sort of visible. It's like these cracks in the social system that have always existed, but now like the cracks are too big that now everyone sees that. It's like, oh, it turns out like this society we've set up is not built for disaster, and it's not built to take care of people, and it's in fact built to sort of crush people and to ensure capital. And again, like Karl Marx was a long time ago, so there's plenty of people who always knew this, but like my understandings of these things were radically altered by COVID and by I just think about all of these things. I mean, obviously a big part of Goodbye Dragon Inn is this sadness, and it's about the death of this movie theater and about the death of these slow movies. Not necessarily a slow movie, because Dragon is not a slow movie. That's, I misspoke. But it's about the death of the way cinema used to be. And Chai Ming-Liang is not one of these like fetishists who's like shoots everything on 35mm, has to make things classical, won't take place in modern. Like, you know, like Paul Thomas Anderson is never going to have a shot of a smartphone in one of his fucking movies. Like, he just, you know what I mean? There's just like certain people who are just like, all right, from now on, I'm only making movies about the 70s because I can't make a fucking movie about 2023. This is not Chai Ming-Liang. He is making movies about modern life. He's done VR installations where he sort of gives VR tours of his home and shot with 360 cameras that way. On Stray Dogs, he embraced digital technology and what digital cameras gave him the ability to like shoot super long takes and stuff like that. Like, that is Stray Dogs is about as far as a Robert Zemeckis movie as you can get, but it's also a movie about someone taking technology and saying, how do I tell a different kind of story with this? Goodbye Dragon Inn is nonetheless like very mournful of sort of this passing of time and what goes and what we lose in the process. He's also someone who is concerned with like sort of unexplainable physical illnesses, the reoccurring neck pains that is sort of dramatized in The River and explored in the most recent feature, Days. That's real. Lee Kang-sheng's real thing that happened to him. He you know, a lot of the footage from Days is not staged for the movie. It is documentary footage of him actually receiving different styles of treatments, trying to figure out what's going on with his neck. Chai Ming-Liang is constantly concerned with the breakdown of the body and the frailty of the body and the just how we are sort of susceptible to illness and people in our lives dying of cancer and things of this nature, and like watching someone on their deathbed pass away in front of your eyes. He's concerned with sort of gentrification and homelessness, and sort of the criminalization of homelessness is something that has been a very strong movement in recent years. I just read a news article today. Turns out a lot of the people lobbying for laws and stuff that criminalize homelessness and make it harder to be a homeless person, those are private prisons who are looking for more free labor.
So gross.
It's fucking horrifying, but it is also just like, this is the world we live in. I'm very sad. I did not write down in my notes. I meant to the name of the man who was just strangled to death in New York City just for having mental illness issues on a subway, and the sort of how that became a hotbed of like different takes on whether or not it's okay to kill human beings if they make you uncomfortable. Like we live in a world that is increasingly, like, all of these anxieties are only increasing for everybody. And Chai Ming-Liang, despite making movies mostly, you know, his feature film work slows down dramatically after Goodbye Dragon Inn. Or I guess it's more, it's a slow down.
It's after Visage, really.
Yeah, Visage. There's 4 years in between Visage and Stray Dogs, and then Stray Dogs is where there's.
Stray Dogs was what everyone thought that was his last film for a long time. I remember I remember hearing that was going to be his last film when it came out, and then it felt like, you know, that was Days was a surprise for I think a lot of people.
Despite the fact that so many of these movies are made long before, I mean, Hole is about it's like literally about isolation. It's like literally about people social distancing. It's about people who are terrified to be near each other because they think they might spread this strange virus. But the nature of that virus, where people are cockroaches, that is a metaphor that he utilizes to examine the way that people actually live in urban environments and how we already are sort of dehumanized and already sort of are treated like insects and sort of scrape out these existences for us ourselves in the squalor and filth and stuff like that. Like, that's a movie where it's raining all the time and there's constant shots out of windows where you just see trash falling from people. Like, people are just tossing trash out their windows, and in this apartment complex there's just constantly trash falling from the sky. There's like all of these things have always been human concerns or whatever, but like I just feel like COVID has sharpened so many of them, and I feel when I watch all of his movies I'm constantly thinking about COVID in a way that I just like. I think if you want to understand the era we live in now, you can do a lot worse than to watch the films of Tsai Ming-Liang and to think about how he already viewed our world. That is a personal read. That's not necessarily a broad motif.
But that is a
personal relationship I have with his work.
Yeah, no. I mean, I think I associate... Well, I mean, the one New York Film Festival that was totally online because of COVID was the year that Days was part of the lineup. So I did see it at home for its festival premiere, which is... You know, not the ideal way to see it, but yeah, I was thinking about that watching certainly The Hole, but also Goodbye Dragon Inn, and maybe The River also. But I was thinking about those, the pandemic and quarantining and such, and social distancing and all of these things. You know, not so much while watching Stray Dogs, but I mean, I guess I was thinking just about like the tough environmental conditions. I mean, that certainly like feels is, you know, resonant now as and is when it was made in, you know, 2013. But you know, because I think more about homelessness than I probably did in 2013, just because I hear about it more and more. But I think compared to the filmmakers that you know, disappear into period settings, and Tarantino is another one that I think of as like, you know, it's a little frustrating to me that, you know, when directors refuse to engage in the contemporary stories, but I mean, at the same time, I can't, you know, artists are going to do what they're going to do. I can't really fault them for it. And it's, you know, something like Days is a very, very private kind of film to me. I mean, it feels like it's aware of the outside world, but I mean, I think it feels like, I mean, even compared to the earliest films, it feels like it was a total two-hander. I don't even know those other characters credited beyond the two main people. Like it feels like when Bergman came back out of retirement to do Saraband, like it's, you know, like it feels like here's just one more, but it's like something so intimate and so small.
I mean, a lot of the footage in Days is an anomaly within his work, because Days was not conceived of as a feature. Days is a lot of footage that he was already shooting that, for whatever reason, he eventually realized, oh, I think this could be a feature film. And he found a way to make it work retroactively. But like footage he was shooting of Li Kangsheng getting his treatments, or footage of the other actor whose name I can't recall at the moment, like that, a lot of that was he shot not knowing what it was going to be used for, in a way that I don't think is true of his other features. But did you have anything else to say about Goodbye Dragon Inn?
No, I think we covered it.
All right. So it can be argued that I did argue that Goodbye Dragon Inn, with its nostalgia humor and warm gestures between characters, in some ways acts as a respite from the bitter pain that defines so much of Simon Liang's work that came before it. But following Goodbye Dragon Inn, his work shifted in the opposite direction. If Goodbye Dragon Inn is the movie that the cinephile world, at the very least, has sort of embraced as his greatest work, Chiming Liang would not respond by running towards them, opening his arms and trying to embrace them back. He would get increasingly challenging, aggressive, and confrontational with an audience. He followed it in 2006 with The Wayward Cloud. The Wayward Cloud actually inspired walkouts and loud protests in its festival screenings, with its combination of overblown camp musicals and an explicit and at times vicious view of the porn industry, creating a tonal whiplash that left audiences stunned. The sequence that inspired the most ire was a lengthy and darkly comedic necrophilic sex scene that we talked about earlier. That scene ends with a long extended close-up of the female lead getting a penis forced in her mouth, accompanied by loud extended gurgling choking noises. It's genuinely tough to watch. And there was lots of loud walkouts and debates reported from different film festivals that screen Wayward Cloud.
It's funny. I saw that one not knowing. Someone lent it to me. I didn't even really make the connection that it was a Tsai Ming-Liang film. They lent it to me with a bunch of like Japanese pink films, like sexploitation films.
Wow.
So I saw it like alongside, you know, things like the what are those films? Like the Scorpion, Lady Scorpion, Prisoner, like kind of like that kind of stuff. Like in like. And things that were like more of an erotica nature. So I saw it like surrounded by straight up sexploitation. And so I saw like I'd forgotten that it was him, you know, and it's interesting to me that like that was my first context for it. It was not that it was, you know, from the director of What Time Is It There and Rebels of Neon God. It was like, oh, it's a newer sex film from Asia.
When I was Googling around, I found that it did end up on a few like listicles about like transgressive films, fucked up films to watch. Like, it's very funny to think of a Chiming Liang movie ending up on the same thing as like Irreversible or whatever, but it was nonetheless, yeah, it sometimes gets listed among those movies.
And it was one of his only hits at home. Like, that this actually was a commercial success in the way that his other films typically are not in Taiwan.
And it won two prizes at the Berlin International Film Festival. It won the Alfred Bauer Award for opening new perspectives on cinematic art, which seems to me to be like just a divine euphemism, and a Silver Bear for outstanding artistic achievement. Chai's next feature, the 2006 film I Don't Want to Sleep Alone, would feature long extended extreme close-ups of Li Kangsheng playing a brain-dead man in a coma, forcing the audience to sit with the inhumanity and suffering of a body breaking down. In the midst of a story about immigration, homelessness, prejudice, gay jealousy, and environmental disaster, it won a special Cinema for Peace Award at the Venice Film Festival. I feel like the last movie, I feel like such a big part of his filmography up to this point is humor. Like, that is, it's not, they're not comedies necessarily, but like, he uses humor to balance the tone, and he uses humor to offset the pain, and he uses, you know, it's just a big tool for him, is the way he employs humor. I really don't think that's true after Wayward Cloud. There's like some amusing moments with Jean-Pierre Léaud in Visage, but generally speaking, I don't think of any movie after Wayward Cloud as featuring much humor as like a way of regulating the story or the tone of a movie.
I'm trying to remember if there's any humor with the kids at all in Stray Dogs or if it's all heavy, but yeah, I think I mostly agree. I'm trying to think if there's anything. I mean, there's humor. I'm trying to think if there's humor in any of the musical numbers. No, there's humor in Visage with the Salome, I thought, right? I'm trying to think.
The musical numbers there are a little more, they feel more like, honestly, like they feel more like a Wong Kar-wai, like luxury brand, like fashion commercial than they do, like the goofy sort of 60s Cantonese pop that exists in the Wayward Cloud and the whole.
Yeah.
There's a little, like, but Visage... Again, I find that to be so challenging. So I might not be detecting some of it just because, like, I don't understand the context for what's happening so often in that film.
Yeah, I don't know. I would say that I Don't Want to Sleep Alone was one that I have seen it, but it was actually one of the hardest ones to see because I rented the DVD and it came cracked. And then I'd found torrents of it, but they didn't. The subtitles didn't match up. I did find it on Dailymotion, so I did watch, I guess, like a rip of the DVD or something. It was kind of, I mean, it was watchable, but it was not like the greatest presentation, so it was a little bit more challenging.
Yeah, I will say, generally speaking, his films are kind of out of print. They're hard to see. We've talked about the difficulty of tracking them down in some ways. The River, Hole, and I Don't Want to Sleep Alone are all on archive.org. And I'll just so you don't need to figure it out yourself, go to the version of I Don't Want to Sleep Alone on archive.org and delay the subtitles by 19 seconds, and then it works fine. So there's your cheat code. But all of those movies are worth seeing. But as part of the 2007 Venice Film Festival, Chai Ming-Liang set up an art installation built around showing Goodbye Dragon Inn in a space that was decorated with his artwork of places that inspired the film. This was the first, but it was far from his last step into the world of art installations and museums. Goodbye Dragon Inn became a bit of a calling card for him for that sort of fine art world. And that sort of is how he began this later stage of his career, stepping away from theatrical exhibition. Ironically, with a film, with a film sort of about the death of theatrical exhibition, it was certainly the death of theatrical exhibition in his own career, because it was what would lead to him, for example, in 2009, becoming the first filmmaker to have a film in the Louvre's permanent collection when they commissioned Visage, which is a complicated and discursive meta feature starring Lee Kang Sheng as a Taiwanese filmmaker making a film for the Louvre. Yeah, I am curious, because it seems like you enjoy this film more than I do. I like all of his movies, but like, this is the one that I really struggle to get through every time. What are your feelings on Visage, real quick?
I've only seen it once, and it's not one of my favorites, but I think with like with this one and I Don't Want to Sleep Alone, I was just so on the train already, as far as like, they just felt like it's more variations on these ideas, and here's certain faces I recognize again, and here's so Visage. I think I expected to be more of a departure than it was, because I think beyond the fact that it's like got this French setting and some French actors, it feels like very much of a piece to me with the other films. Like, it doesn't feel like a great like, it's not like my Blueberry Nights or something where it's like,
no,
I've
that's
really
true.
Like, you know, like really kind of rethink, like, how does this fit in? Like, it feels like, oh, it's still him doing what he does. I think I don't know, it felt like it was telling me something about what it's like to be him as a filmmaker in a way that like maybe some of the other films like feel like more like indirectly dealing with like his emotions and desires and concerns. Like, this feels like acknowledging who he is
in a way that I was kind of intrigued by. But yeah, I mean, I don't know if I have like prepared notes or like a great defense for it. I just thought, you know, that it was an attractive looking film. I thought it had like the moment where like he's having the hookup in the woods and like gets the news that his mother died felt like such a weird mix of tones that I thought was like an interesting scene. How it all adds up, I think I was just taking it as another installment of a larger project by that point.
Sure. Visage also the most difficult to see. Story about Visage on DVD that might tell a little something about the sort of mindset of Chai Ming-Liang in terms of home video and perhaps why so many of his films struggle to get proper releases. He tells a story about Wayward Cloud. This is a story he told at this lecture that I attended. He said that they made 2,000 DVDs of Wayward Cloud for Taiwan, and it sold 50. And the rest of them ended up in the bargain bin. And whenever he was in a video store or something and he saw them selling for Wayward Cloud for cheap, he felt it was demeaning and he felt dejected. So he would make sure to buy them so no one else could buy his movies at that price. So when it came time for Visage, which he knew was not more accessible than Wayward Cloud, he decided what he was going to do was, instead of releasing 2,000 DVDs and hoping to sell them all at this certain price point, he was going to do 10 DVDs, and he was going to create super limited edition special boxes out of wooden crates, and he was going to paint them with scenes from the movie, and he was going to sell each of them for $1 million. And he said, and he sold two of them. I don't know if the translation, this is a lecture that was done through a translator. I don't know if this is $1 million Taiwanese dollars. I don't know if $1 million is a figurative thing or if he literally sold these boxes for $1 million, but he sold two of the 10 and made way more money that way than he did, releasing Wayward Cloud the way he did. So, MoMA has one of these wooden crates, and there's some Taiwanese museum that also has one. That story is, for me, like, obviously, none of his movies are going to be like, oh, finally, Dawn of the Dead's in 4K. Like, none of his movies are going to be, like, massive unit movers, but, like, there is a demand for these movies that is not met by, Region 1 releases, at the very least. I think they're a little bit easier to find in France, but... and I think that he might be a roadblock himself to that being the case, because he doesn't seem to take too kindly to the video market.
Well, he appears on the All Region Blu-ray for Goodbye Dragon Inn from Second Run, but there's a really nice edition of Rebels of the Neon God. He's not involved in the special features for that. There's a bare bones Blu-ray for Viva l'Amour, I think, that came out not too long ago. And there's a nice two-disc special edition for Days. I think that's... And there's a nice special edition for Stray Dogs. So those for U.S. listeners, these are the best options for home video for him. But yeah, there's quite a lot that came out through like Wellspring kind of releases that are out of print. And I don't know like if the cost to restore them to, you know, high def transfers that people would expect. Like, I don't know if there's a financial barrier, but I feel like, you know, when I talk about like the filmmakers that were kind of hot in the film comment world when I first heard about Tsai Ming-Liang, a lot of them are not that well represented on home video. I mean, even people like Bellatar are just starting to show up gradually. But
that's
like,
true.
I think like there's major films from Apichapong that are not available. Asias, who's a pretty, you know, mainstream by the standards of these guys. I mean, there's a lot of his that are not available. You know, the Dardens, you know, like, so, yeah, Ho Shoshen, So it's, you know, Unknown Pleasures. Like, there's a lot of like key films from that period of art house cinema that they're not old enough to be treated with the same respect as Bergman and Fellini, and they're not new enough to be treated with the same respect as Hong Sang-soo or whoever, you know, is like currently making the rounds.
Right.
And so it's just like that weird kind of transition format to format, and these are the kind of films that are not safe bets for the home video labels that are working with they're working with either safe bets or they're charging a lot or both. You know, so I don't know. I mean, I'd love to see all these films that we're talking about. I mean, even the ones that I'm less, you know, passionate about, like something like Visage. I would love to, you know, see something that really puts it in context with a, you know, and treats the visual beauty of it, like, you know, respectfully on home video. I mean, certainly I think that would make a big difference with my feelings about, I mean, not that I enjoy films like The Hole and The River, but I feel like I would enjoy them even more if they looked like they're supposed to look.
Yeah.
You know,
The Hole, so, I think The River looks okay. I think there is some release of The River that is,
there is
a pretty good. The Hole is one that I've only ever seen in a pretty bad DVD transfer. That is unfortunate, because that movie is even more than some of these other movies. That movie is so much about the vibe and about the environments and about the textures and the tactile nature of them.
Yeah, I just think that, like, I mean, it's a very different kind of filmmaker. But I remember when I was growing up with the films of Dario Argento, and Dario Argento's films always were severely compromised on VHS, which is how we, you know, all could see them, you know, pan and scan and cut and all of that. And it made such a big difference in my appreciation for them to see them widescreen, uncut, remastered. And I feel like it's not quite as extreme with Tsai Ming-Liang, but I feel like his films are not being compromised in terms of framing or content, but it's like, yeah, these are beautiful films that are like, you know, like having to like transcend kind of really mediocre or worse kind of presentations on home video. And the fact that he's not as keen on that earlier, you know, phase of his career is not gonna, I mean, but people that know, I mean, he's a name brand auteur. I mean, I'm sure some labels would kill to have any of these films in their catalog. So it's just, I don't know. Sometimes it's just the rights holders want X number of dollars that it's unfeasible, and sometimes it's just, yeah, the cost of bringing it up to a professional standard is the prohibitive factor. So I don't know. I mean, Criterion has never put out one of his films, but I mean, obviously they're aware of him. I mean, so maybe him, them, or because it's not like there's that many labels that specialize in that. I mean, film movement. You know, there's a couple that could do him justice that would want to. But yeah, I feel like these are like risky projects and probably not cheap.
Right. It is one of those things where it's just like, oh, there could just be a box set of all these. Even if just the movies threw Goodbye Dragon in, because they're just so essential as viewed as a part. You know, like, it's just like all these like little just echoes that I'm just like, oh, if that could all be presented together, it'd be perfect. Even outside of his features, he has a different collection of shorts that are essential to his sort of brand and sort of what he is known for as an auteur. That began in 2011, I want to say, because they were inspired by a 2011 stage play that was put on by Tsai Ming-Liang and Lee Kang-shang, where Lee Kang-shang demonstrated his ability to walk at extremely slow speeds, which is a form of Zen walking meditation called Qinhin, which I think I'm mispronouncing, so sorry about that. He crossed from stage left to stage right over the course of half an hour, and that was the theatrical production. He would try to cross the stage as slow as possible, and sometimes it would take up to, you know, over 30 minutes to do. This formed the Walker series. To date, there are 9 Walker shorts, and they all feature a similar structure. Lee Kang-shang, dressed in the orange robes of a Buddhist monk, walking at miraculously slow speeds in public spaces as the modern world sort of exists around him. In these films, it's not unusual for a single step to take longer than a minute. Shorts in this series include No Form, Sleepwalk, Walker, No No Sleep, and Journey to the West. They transplant the action in different countries. There are different settings, but the core premise, the pace, and the static camera work remains unchanged. Bill, have you seen any of these Walker films?
I have seen Journey to the West, and I thought that was really compelling. I got it. I mean, I get what he was doing, and I found it totally hypnotizing. And just because it's going to kill me if I don't mention it, since I just wanted to shout out the labels, Grasshopper is the label that put out Days, and the Cinema Guild put out Stray Dogs. And Stray Dogs, the Blu-ray, includes Journey to the West as one of the bonus features. So that's definitely like an essential home video package just for the 1-2 punch. And Days also has multiple films, not just Days. It also has Afternoon and what I think a short film. So, back to Journey to the West. Is the only Walker film I've seen. I think I was curious to see more, but I know that this is the most famous one. I'm trying to think what it reminded me of. I think the one I compared it to in my head, and I don't know if it's just because of the length, was the Skywalk Is Gone. That's the thing I thought of watching it, and I don't know if it's just because of the location and the city in the daytime, and just the fact that it wasn't like obligated to tell a story because of the short film format.
The Walker series is something I resisted for a while, until obviously when I was preparing for this podcast, I said, all right, fine, I'm trying to watch as much as I can. I'll watch the Walker series as well, but I know I'm not going to like it. Walker series is one of those things where I hear the premise of it and I got the idea. The act of sitting and watching these things is irrelevant, because I understand that he's doing a thing where you're walking very slowly and the hustle and bustle of the modern world. Da, 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 da. Like, I was like, that's already something I get from his feature films. I don't need to watch these Walker movies. They're probably just going to be endurance tests and be boring as hell. Watching someone walk slowly is not necessarily like the log line that makes audiences or executives drool, you know? Like, it's not it doesn't get butts in seats.
It sounds like a parody of slow cinema.
It does. It sounds like the kind of thing where if I describe that, in fact this did happen to me. I said, oh, I'm preparing, I'm talking to my coworker. I'm like, oh, I'm preparing for this podcast on this Taiwanese director. And I was describing the kind of works he makes. And I was like, oh, I saw this really great film the other day. It's called No, No Sleep. And I described it. And it just sounds like it sounds like a joke. The thing that I did not know about the Walker series is that I complained that the humor had mostly disappeared from his work post Wayward Cloud. That is actually not true, because the Walker series is funny. Especially when you look at Journey to the West, there is a game that it is playing, which is like, where's Waldo? It's where's Lee Kang Sheng? It is every shot starts and you know what it's going to contain, because that is the central premise of this movie. And it's an hour long. But he's not always like front and center in the frame. You don't always know where he is. And because he's moving so slowly, your realization of where he is, it's not an instant, like, you don't see him and then you see him because he walks on screen. It is like, there's a scene where you just see a man in his kitchen, like preparing tea or something. And you're like, oh, okay. I guess there's a little digressive alternate story about this man making himself a drink. And then, like, slowly you realize in the background of him in the window is Lee Kang Sheng, because you just see the orange, because he's wearing this orange robes. And you're like, oh, there he is. So, like, there's that. The thing it made me think of is Tom Green, of all people, had an MTV special where he went to Japan and did a bunch of Tom Green pranks in Japan. And one of the things he did was he was like, oh, I'm so jet lagged, I'm so sleepy. And he sat on the stairs to the Japanese subway, and Japan being a very crowded, busy place where people are trying to get to work, and but they're also like not super aggressive, confrontational, generally speaking. Like, they're all trying to very politely move around him as he is just totally disrupting them. There is a prank show element to the fact that there is only one person in this movie. Actually, that's not true of Journey to the West, because of what's his name?
Dennis Levant.
Because Dennis Levant becomes the sort of acolyte who also an extremely physical actor starts to follow him. But for the most part, everyone you see in this movie is just a person living their lives in the city. And Li Kangsheng is the subject and he's the only one who knows he's in a movie. Or he's, sometimes people stop and like take out their phones and take a picture of him. like there's just so many like little weird things, but it is like almost a prank show thing where he is making a spectacle of himself, and the way that he interferes with other people's lives is both a statement about, yes, about the pace of modern life and the sort of way that you have crowds and crowds of human beings and none of them consider each other as human beings. They are all just this mass of people coming, you know, it's like, whatever, I've seen Koyaanisqatsi, the people going in all down off the train, you know, Grand Central Station, they go down the stairs, whatever. Like there's that, but it also, the way it does it is not like super self-serious the way you might think. The way it does it is very funny. I think Walker is the first of these shorts. If it's not the first, it's one of the first. Walker, features Li Kangsheng with one of the sort of ubiquitous convenience store plastic bags around his hand. So as he's walking, he also just has a little plastic bag dangling from his hand. The very end of the movie, he finally gets somewhere and he like hits a wall and he just stops. And then it cuts to a close up, which you basically never see in these movies. You don't see a close up. They're all about the environment. So there are all these big long shots where he is a tiny figure in the frame. It cuts to a close up and you see his hand slowly go up to the bottom of the frame. And he has like a sweet bun that he brings to his mouth and he eats it. And it's like such a funny punchline to a movie like Walker. I've seen three of these movies. I've seen No No Sleep, I've seen Walker, and I've seen Journey to the West. And they have a sense of humor to them that is surprising, that you might not expect. If you Google around, you can find Walker on Vimeo. Someone's just sort of illegally uploaded Walker. And Journey to the West is on YouTube in a different form. If you're curious about it, but you don't actually want to watch an hour of someone walking slowly, someone has taken Journey to the West and sped it up 6 times, which is not the movie that Ming-Liang made. I'm not saying like this is a valid way to experience Journey to the West, but it is an interesting demonstration of the effect, because you see these crowds of people moving in fast motion like an undercrank camera, and you see Li Kangsheng walking still quite slowly. Like upstairs and stuff, and it has the feeling of like macro footage of ants or something. Like it's a if you are curious but don't want to commit to watching a full short of the Walker series, search for Journey to the West Ming-Liang on YouTube and you can find that. I found that interesting as well. Long before the Walker series, the Ming-Liang had been associated with the nebulous tag of slow cinema, but this is the era, this is sort of the section of his career where he's pushing it further and further, which I think is maybe a good way to bring us into the final film we're going to be talking about today, the 2013 feature film Stray Dogs. Stray Dogs is about a family of homeless people living in an abandoned building. The father, played by Li Kangsheng, works as a human billboard for luxury apartments. And we watch and observe their life in a observational mode that is honestly, despite the fact that inside of the cinema of whatever that little diagram that Paul Schrader made, I don't find Ming-Liang's works to be very surveillance oriented. This is the movie that is the most observational at times. You are literally sitting and watching someone do their job. Like I've said multiple times, first time I see a Ming-Liang movie, I get the most surface level. I am not a Roger Ebert empathy machine. Like, I don't think that's how cinema actually works. And I don't think that is something that cinema does that's unique to other art forms. Like, that quote is perhaps tied to a larger essay that I would agree with and find more well thought, but I find the thing that people actually quote, which is cinema is an empathy machine, I often roll my eyes. but the first time I watched this, my main experience was sitting in a movie theater and watching a shot that, at the time, having not been as accustomed to Ming-Liang and having never seen this film in particular, I thought this shot went on for 9 minutes. It goes on for 3 minutes. It's not that long in the realm of, even inside of this film, the shots of Li Kangsheng as the human billboard are not exceptionally long. But I felt I was going to be there forever. And part of that is because you don't have any context. You don't have a story. You don't have any dialogue up to that point. You don't know who this person is. You don't know what you're supposed to be gaining from the scene. You don't know what the next shot is going to be. This is the movie that feels the most like art installation, which is you could walk into a museum and see any moment from this, and you could sit down on a bench in this art museum and watch 15 minutes of this movie at any point, and you will have a full experience in a way that just isn't true of what time is it there or the river or something like that. Like, these shots, almost every scene plays out in a single master shot. These shots have with them their own internal meaning and context and emotional content, and they don't feel particularly strongly built around cause and effect. It's a difficult movie. I mentioned earlier I've seen this movie 5 times. The 3 of those times I have fallen asleep at one point or another. I have a tendency to put this movie on when I'm very tired because it is a movie that I can't meditate. Like, I have intrusive thoughts, and like when I try to clear my mind, it just fills up with heinous shit. And actually, that's something true of the Walker series as well. The closest I get to meditation is watching these movies. For example, when I walk through the streets of Chicago, I always, always, always need to be listening to either music or a podcast or something. I can't listen to the sounds of the city around me because what happens is my brain isn't occupied, and then it fills up with heinous shit because it's just intrusive thoughts. That's just how my brain is built. That's the chemicals. That's the hand I was dealt. Whatever. But when I watch the Walker series, I can like sort of hyper focus on the sounds of the city and sort of exist in this space as he slowly travels through Hong Kong or through Marseille or whatever. Stray Dogs is a similar thing where I can. It allows me to sort of experience urban environments in a way I can't normally. It's not until this most recent viewing that I actually had like a take on like, this is what this movie is about. I mostly just thought some of it was compelling and some of it wasn't, but all of it was unlike anything I had ever seen. But I'm curious, Bill, how Stray Dogs hit you.
I think it's one of his best films. I feel like it, to me, I'm glad I saw it when I did. I think when it came out, I remember Travis Crawford, my friend, was a big fan of all of Simon Lang's films, and this one was one of his favorites of the year when it came out. And I remember thinking that this was going to be a grueling film to sit through, just based on what I knew its approach to be. So I just waited until I was going to be able to take it on its own terms. And when I saw it, I really found it felt like the end of the line in a good way. It felt like this is as extreme as we're going to take the style without it breaking the film. Like, it felt like a good last film at the time that I saw it. And I think that, superficially, I think of things like Shoplifters or Parasite that like deal with like families that are on the margins or, you know, like, and like trying to persevere, but like, then kicking off like a series of like some kind of story. This doesn't really break into the story that I think I expect it to do because of those kind of films. Like, I still don't quite understand certain things, like why he has all 3 of his most prominent like actresses all playing the same character depending on the scene. At least that's what I've read. I don't know if that's true or if that's, yeah, I don't know that they like intercut it like from, it's not like that obscure object of desire where like a woman walks into the room and then like walks out and then comes in as a different person. It's not like that.
I am fairly confident it is in fact the same character. That was one of the key things, is like, I didn't even think this was a narrative film until like maybe the last 2 times I saw it. I thought it purely existed in the realm of the avant-garde and the dream at the end, and it's only like recently I was able to watch it and realize that this is a consistent character who works at the supermarket.
Yeah. I thought it had like such haunting scenes, and I think that, you know, I mean, there are scenes that, like, I feel like when he's eating like chicken and it goes for like several minutes of screen time, I feel like, okay, you can't keep going further like in this direction because it's, well, I guess you can, but I mean it's really changing the form to something that I don't even know, like it does feel like closer to gallery installation kind of work at this point. It doesn't feel like
Like, he's interested in, like, making a film, the way we think of them. But that's not uninteresting. Like, I mean, I think that, I don't know, like, in some ways I thought of Goodbye Dragon Inn. I mean, what I'm, but instead of watching someone watch a movie, I'm watching someone look at a mural, or like something, like, you know, looking at the sea. Like, I'm still watching someone watch something. And I thought of, yeah, I mean, I, like I said earlier, like, I thought of, like, just like the grueling job, the economic anxiety theme, and also the sexual dysfunction theme. And in a way, also, it was like, is it the first film with, like, little kids since the beginning? I'm trying to think. Like, I don't think I had seen the TV movies before. So, like,
yeah, I think the TV movies are the last time he worked with little kids.
Yeah. So I thought that was interesting. I mean, I don't know if I was, like, thinking so much about the jump from celluloid to digital, although, I mean, if you pointed out, I definitely am aware of it. But, yeah, no, it's not a film that I would probably rewatch a whole lot. It's not a film that I would start off a newbie to Simon Lang's films with.
No.
But I think that, I think it's one of his best films. I think it's one of his great films, but it is kind of like, yeah, I mean, it's like Hard to Be a God or something. It's kind of a masterpiece, but it's not an easy watch, and it's not an easy film to recommend to a newbie. And I also think it makes an interesting companion to something like Journey to the West, because it is about characters, like, in kind of like a slow private experience in a bustling public setting. Like, I think that they make interesting kind of companions that way, and I don't know that they were even conceived along the same lines. I mean, they're not too far apart in terms of when they were made, but I don't know that I don't know that they were made to consciously resonate with one another.
So I think when you talk about Stray Dogs, this is the movie that is like the audaciously slow cinema. The shot lengths, the pacing of his earlier work, it certainly is slower than the average. It's, you know, what time is it there is going to be. There's many other films that from Asia at that time that are sort of tackling that loneliness and isolation and the feeling of being displaced and all that. But, like, you're not going to see many of those movies that have that tempo and pace and stuff like that. But, like, Stray Dogs is the movie that ends with the 17-minute uninterrupted shot of a close-up of someone's face staring at a mural, followed by, like, a 4-minute shot of the reverse shot of them, of that mural. Like, this is where he starts pushing it much further to any concept of, like, I'm trying to be approachable is totally shattered. And I'm curious about slow cinema in general. We've sort of been dancing around it. We've talked about, like, Bellatar or whatever. Something I feel ambivalence about is that I don't know if there is such thing as slow cinema movement. Like, I don't know if any of these filmmakers are, like, talking to each other. I don't think Ming-Liang is thinking about Wirkmeister harmonies when he's making, you know, Stray Dogs. I don't think Bellatar is thinking about Ming-Liang when he makes Turin Horse. Like, it's hard for me to, like, these things get lumped together.
Yeah, I think yeah, a Pitchapong is a fan of Simon Liang. Like, the I mean, there are some acknowledgement of one another, but yeah, no, I totally agree that I don't really think of them as having that much in common other than a slow pace.
So many of those movies are sort of lumped in slow cinema. That's the only thing that they have in common. I think Stray Dogs is a movie that could be, like, obviously anyone who's going to be standing out getting blasted with wind and rain, holding up signs for luxury apartments when they're homeless. Like, that is a heart-wrenching emotional state for anyone. But, like, when you see the weathered face, when you see that close-up, when you hear him start singing, like, it means so much more when you feel the full weight of a person instinctually as a viewer of Ming-Liang's work in a way that again, like the idea of if homeless people are people who are dehumanized and are looked over and people just walk past them and walk on by and like they don't consider their lives, like one way to tell the story of the unhoused is home. The truth is homeless person is now like such a common phrase that it used to be descriptive and now it's dehumanizing to even just say like unhoused person is a more appropriate phrase. That's what I should be saying. Like one way to tell the story of the unhoused person is to like build a narrative about like, oh, you know, their fall from great, you know, they used to be this and they used to have all this and then they just had a few bad breaks and any one of us could be in their position. And don't we feel bad that they don't belong there? And maybe every unhoused person we see doesn't belong there. Da-da. But like another way to do it is just to like cast Lee Kang Sheng and have an investment through all these other movies. And I think like if all cinema is subjective, if all movies don't exist on the screen, they exist on your brain, they exist in some midpoint in between your eyeballs and the screen and like the way your brain processes it. And like that's the reason editing works, is because you are putting two disparate images together and you're finding the meaning. Like slow cinema is ceding more ground to your imagination and it's expecting, and through its lack of dialogue and through its long takes and through its minimalist narratives and stuff, it is putting more of the responsibility on you to find the emotional through line. And I think that the fact that it is a slow film that has Lee Kang Sheng and it has Liu Yiqing and Yang Kui-mei and Chen Xiang-chi, like I think all of these things work in a way that if another filmmaker, if this was the debut feature of someone, I don't think it would be as powerful.
Oh, I totally agree.
But yeah. because he's so self-knowingly, you know, he utilizes that. This is part of his tactic, is to constantly like cast these people and to like form these relationships and like even this. So the main problem with Stray Dogs, and the reason why I'm like struggling to find words, is that I think it's about Buddhism and I don't know Buddhism. And like I it's like I'm really hesitant to even step into this arena because like it turns out you can't become an expert in Buddhist philosophy with 3 weeks of Googling essays. So like all of the knowledge that I tenuously kind of sort of grasp from random Google results has already rapidly left my brain because I don't have a strong understanding of it. But I think Stray Dogs is about how the world is suffering and how that the things that are real is our physical bodies and how they suffer and how they struggle and how we are born to die and the pain we feel and the realities of your daily needs of you need to eat, you need to shit, you need to sleep. You have sexual desires, like all of these things that need to constantly be attended to and maintained. And then there's a false reality that has been built up around it that the average person living in a city lives in and exists in and has faith in and believes in. And that is the reality of the massive grocery store supermarket that is just like this bizarre dreamscape of colors and brands and salespeople. And like every shot inside of a grocery store in this movie nearly is like all shot through windows or reflections or glass or obscured in some way. And it is this like fictional reality, the capitalist reality that we all live in, of like, well, you grow up and you go to school and you get a job and this, and like this is all what it means to be a human. None of that is what it means to be a human. All of that is this like dream, and the actual what it means to be human is suffering. And the final shot at the end, they're looking at this mural of a beach. That is our connection to the world around us, is we see things through a glass darkly, which is not Buddhism, that's the Bible, but
but like, Bergman.
yeah exactly. That is as close as we can get, is, you know, or Plato's cave, for example, you want to go to a different philosophy. And so much of this movie is about the states that different characters are in where they're able to deny reality. and where they're not able to deny reality. And someone who cannot deny reality, who cannot deny that life is suffering, that life is a constant ticking time bomb of needs. Time bomb is a bad metaphor, but it's like it's constantly draining needs that you need to fulfill over and over and over again. And there's intense pressure to do it because you need money to do so. Like the unhoused person is distinctly aware of that. And as soon as he ends up in this like this nightmarish dream setting where he has this like domestic situation inside this burned out house, like the very first shot of this movie is something out of J-horror, where the woman, and because you don't see her face, I can't say exactly which actress it is like brushing her hair for like 5 minutes, and it's in front of her face, and the walls look like a corrugated metal or something. You don't realize until later that it's all burn marks, and there's like children sleeping on a mattress, and it just looks like a nightmare scene. And it's the dream. And so this is me rambling because I don't have like a way to contextualize all of this, but I did want to say, like, I think this is a movie about the division between reality and the dream that modern life has sort of put over our eyes. This is Chiming Liang's The Matrix. No, but in some ways it is, but also I wanted to use that as an entry point to talk about, again, totally unqualified, but here I am nonetheless. Something about his whole body of work feels very Buddhist, which is the recurring motifs, the recurring people, the idea of people like reliving these lives. The two characters walk by each other in the river on the staircase, and then they walk by each other again on that same staircase on the Skywalk Is Gone. And these same actors who are sort of reliving these lives that are the same people but not the same people, their spirits move on through these different stories. Like, that to me is all reincarnation. There's a reincarnation image in the very first scene of Rebels of the Neon God where he kills a roach and throws it out his window, and then the roach reappears on his window, now alive again. Obviously, like, in that world, which is, that movie is a movie that exists in our objective reality, like, that's a different cockroach. But, like, the image itself is of reincarnation. Chiming Liang is a Buddhist who is making Buddhist works that reflect Buddhist philosophies, and he is exploring his spirituality and his faith through these films. And I think Stray Dogs is the most, like, the only way I can make head or tails of it is through that. So to me, this is the most direct sort of communication of that.
I can follow that. That all makes sense. I'm less of an expert in Buddhism than you are, so I can't challenge any of those points.
Stray Dogs is so experiential that it's like I find it more difficult to talk about than many of these other films that we've been talking about. But that was something I wanted to that was something that clicked into place about his entire body of work watching Stray Dogs this most recent time that I don't know if I was considering before.
Well, I mean, the thing with Stray Dogs is I just think about it as a lot of characters waiting for something. And that's a very hard thing to talk about. I mean, as far as like, you know, it's just like the boredom of transient people, and just being in situations where they get kind of lost in an image or are kind of just withstanding the environment that they're put in. I mean, it's compelling, but it's also, yeah, I mean, there's not only so much to really say about it. I mean, it does seem to have a great deal of focus on ritual, which is something, I mean, I think a lot of the films have, is like, I mean that's something that, okay, what time is it there has a bit of that with the rituals after the father's passed away, and even the, I think of like Days as like at least 50% ritual. I think I associate ritual with the Catholic filmmakers, but I mean, I guess that could be applied to a lot of different religions and ideologies. I mean, but
it's interesting, the use of ritual. There's a lot of Buddhist ceremonies. Obviously, the river is full of there are both spiritual and medical solutions that Xiao Kang seeks to deal with his neck pain in the river. And I hesitate to even talk about the depictions of ritual in the movies because, like, I'm unfamiliar with them, and therefore they come across as, like, alien and strange, and that sort of emphasizes how ineffective they are in treating his neck pain. But also, like, that's me as a Westerner, just unfamiliar. Chai Ming-Liang, the director, has a very different relationship with that sort of thing in a way that, like, I feel I can unpack when Coppola uses Catholic Scorsese uses Catholic ritual. Like, I think I understand where they're coming from there, and I can speak to it more. He's a spiritual filmmaker, I believe, but Chai Ming-Liang is, I do think throughout there is a sort of skepticism towards people who believe that they have the answer. I think the river is very pointed in that, how they go all of this way to see a very specific holy man who goes through this very complicated ritual, and he's explaining what they're doing and what they're waiting for the spirits to tell them, and they spend all this time in a hotel, and after the sort of climactic, humiliating, very ambivalently constructed incest scene, they get a call, and the guy says, you should go see a doctor. Like, there's a lot of skepticism there. Or, like, what time is it there? You have this this monk who's telling her about the yin-yang water that's half boiling water and half cold water, and you leave that out for the spirit of the father. She is killing her houseplant with this water, and I think that is and when you think about the use of water as, like, water represents what people aren't receiving, it's their needs that aren't being met or whatever. The image of someone, like, taking this water that is, like, part boiling and part cold, and, like, pouring it into a plant and killing it is a pretty potent metaphor for, like, how the answers to the suffering of life is not contained in religion necessarily.
You're right. Yeah.
I don't know if I have anything else to say about Stray Dogs.
I think that's all I have to say about it. Other than that it's, I think maybe the most powerful performance of Lee Kang-sheng of all these films for me. I think they all feel like different kinds of love letters to him, but this one feels like, this one and Days feel the ones that feel like the most devoted to him of all of them, weirdly. Which is interesting that they come at the end after all of these stories where he's part of ensembles. It feels like he's really much more the focus, especially by the time you get to Days. Whereas I don't feel that way about the other films, where I feel like he's, like, there's a greater effort to, like, make stories that involve him. These feel like, oh, there's no need for stories. We already have what we need, which is my guy.
Well, know? Yeah. Part of the Walker series is, when Chai Ming-Liang talks about how much he loves doing that series, he compares it to, you know, painters doing still lifes, which is, like, for him, the excitement is he gets to show up at a place and the film presents itself to him, and he just gets to sort of, like, figure out where to put his camera and how to frame it, but he doesn't know what he's going to do. He doesn't come with ideas. All he needs to do is make up Lee Kang-sheng, and put him in the costume, find a place, set up the camera, and then go. And he thinks of himself as, you know, he talks about the gaze. He talks about Goodbye Dragon Inn being where he sort of discovered his love of the gaze, and how he gave the ticket taker woman the limp specifically so it would take her longer to travel through a space, so we would have to consider the space more than considering her. Like that sense certainly comes in Days, I think, more than anything. Days feels like a home movie to me. I am honestly not a big fan of Days. My most recent viewing of it, I was able to, like, vibe with it a little, but Days feels the most undirected and sort of, I guess, purposelessness. I mean, it's a pretty clear narrative. It's about, you know, and it's certainly tied into the narratives of all the other ones about someone who is struggling and about the temporary relief of people, and the ways in which that temporary relief is insufficient to their lives, and the sort of struggle to connect and failure to connect about these, you know, two people who speak different languages. And Chai Ming-Liang very specifically did not want any subtitle dialogue, so nothing in Days, not that there's much dialogue to begin with, but none of it is subtitled, because he doesn't want you he figures that, you know, even viewers in East Asia are probably only going to know at least one of the languages being spoken. And he specifically wants to alienate you from that, to, you know, emphasize that. So, like, there, it's not that it's just like, oh, whatever, he just shot a bunch of crap and put it together and called it a movie. Like, there's the purpose is clear enough. It's much clearer than even something like Visage to me. But, like, I guess I just find, like, someone washing vegetables for 9 minutes less compelling than someone doing pretty much anything else in any of his other movies for 9 minutes.
I mean, when I saw it, I didn't like it when I saw it at the New York Film Festival, because I think I was watching it kind of out of context. It had been a few years since I had seen anything new from him, because I hadn't kept up with, well, I mean, he hadn't made anything in a while, but I felt like out of step with him. And so the fact that I was watching it on a laptop, because it was like a festival all being done virtually, I think it just, yeah, like I said, like watching someone clean vegetables for 6 minutes, you know, I just felt like, all right, I get it. But like, I wasn't like compelled by it or moved by it. And I think when you said that we were going to do this, and I thought, oh, am I going to do the same thing? I thought with Days, because I knew people that thought it was a masterpiece, and I'm like, you know, I maybe if I had seen this at the festival like I was supposed to on the big screen, I would have been enveloped in it. I think I just felt like this did not translate to the laptop kind of viewing experience for me. It just felt like I couldn't get lost in something that slow that way. So I actually bought the Blu-ray for this. I'm like, oh, I've got to buy a $30 Blu-ray for a film I remember not liking for this podcast. Well, we're not even going to really talk about Days. But I did buy it, and I projected it big, and I found that it held me. It worked. I mean, I got it. And I think also just watching it in quick succession with all the other films, I mean, I just was able to focus on the actor and focus on what the years, you know, look like on him now, you know. And I think, I mean, it's not a film that I would start with, and it's not a film that I will probably rewatch a whole lot, but I get what it's doing, and I appreciate it more than the first time I saw it, where I felt like, okay, I didn't need over 2 hours of this. But now I find it kind of a satisfying, if it winds up being the last film, I feel like it's a good, I still feel like Stray Dogs is the last major, the major thing, but this feels like a satisfying, you know, postscript. Whereas before, I felt like there's just too little happening for me to care about the glimmers of humanity that come at the end.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I am very curious to see the only thing I'm really confident about is Chai Ming-Liang is not going to stop working.
Yeah.
He's going to keep, I think since Days, he has made like 3-4 short films. So like, he's going to keep working. Is he ever going to return to features in a narrative way? Like the last real narrative feature, the one that I consider like really strongly driven by narrative would be I Don't Want to Sleep Alone. That's 2006. So I'm going to go ahead and guess that he probably will not. There's probably never going to be another movie as accessible as Goodbye Dragon Inn or something like that. I am excited to continue watching these movies, and because on the surface the rhythms of them and the pacing of them and the visuals of them, his aesthetic eye, just everything about it is I find so agreeable, and I just am someone who has, you know, even before preparing for this podcast, like, I don't own The River on DVD, but the Chicago Public Library has it, and I have rented it from the Chicago Public Library like 4 times because I'm just, I get into a mood where I want to watch The River. And like, I'm going to continue watching these films over and over again. And even if he never makes another feature film, his body of work will continue to open up to me, I believe, and influence who I am and open up my own life to me in other ways that I, you know, this is just undoubtedly one of the most important filmmakers in my life. And so I hope, that the listeners enjoyed this podcast and I hope they found this edifying and that I was able to do justice, to Chai Ming-Liang's work, and that, you were inspired to like seek out difficult film experiences. especially in a world where our attention spans are shrinking and we, you know, we, and the world outside of our homes is worse than ever every day. And so escapism becomes more important every day. Like, I do want to encourage people to seek difficult films and to challenge themselves in that way. And hopefully this podcast is an on-ramp for people to discover a body of work that itself, this body of work is its own on-ramp. Like, he teaches you how to watch his own movies. Part of the way he's able to make Days is because he has already taught you what a Chai Ming-Liang movie is, so he can cut away more of it, which is just one of the fascinating things about watching them chronologically. But
yeah, watching them in chronological order can make even the ones that are less accessible feel like they make sense in like a in that context. Like, I think that it makes films that might seem kind of daunting on their own feel like part of a larger body of work, a larger overall project that I think, yeah, they resonate with each other in interesting ways that I think that, like, yeah, when we talk about like directors on a show like Directors Club, I mean, I think that this is a body of work that like makes sense to consider as a whole, where versus like some maybe that are, you know, more like journeymen or journey persons. I don't know if that term is out of date anymore, but like, yeah, but this one, I mean, even the ones that feel like outliers like Visage are at least interesting, you know, to consider alongside the ones that maybe we're more excited to talk about. I think that there's not like one that I felt like this was a waste of my time. Like, they all felt like interesting. They had something interesting to add to the overall picture for me.
Awesome. And I guess this is Director's Club. At the end, we got to say our three favorite Chai Ming-Liang movies.
Okay.
Do you have that prepared?
Yeah. I mean, I think I could say for three, I would go with Stray Dogs. Two, I would say Rebels of the Neon God. And one, I would say Goodbye Dragon Inn.
And for me, I would say three is The River. Two is What Time Is It There? And one is Goodbye Dragon Inn. Though Stray Dogs, whenever I am actually sitting and watching it, I am overwhelmed in a way I'm not with any of his other films, and also with any other films. Like, it is an overwhelming experience. So Stray Dogs is perhaps maybe his best, and I just don't have like warm fuzzy feelings with it the way I have with something like Goodbye Dragon Inn or What Time Is It There.
I'll give a shout. I really loved Boys. You know, it's not like a profound a work as the is what comes later, but as someone that likes like troubled teen movies and coming of age movies, I think his early TV features are pretty entertaining, and that one I think we didn't really go into it, but I mean, that's worth seeking out if you're a fan of the Rebels of the Neon God.
Those TV movies have way more Chai Ming-Liang in them than you might think. The official filmography always starts with Rebels of the Neon God. Those two are Chai Ming-Liang movies through and through.
Yeah. This gets into a whole other conversation about like why TV movies are not considered part of the filmographies consistently, but you know, with certain directors, but we can get into that another time.
Sure. Thank you so much, Bill. In addition to hearing you on this podcast quite frequently, where else can people find your work?
I'm just toiling away on this Directors Club episode on Godard, but my old episodes of Supporting Characters are on the Now Playing Network, and I've done a few home video things that have come out in the last few months. If you have the means to watch Region B Blu-rays, Amanda Reyes and I did the commentary for the Texas Chainsaw Massacre for Second Sight, and Travis Crawford and I did the commentary for Death Dream for 101 Films. Those are most recent home video things I've worked on, and there's a few things coming out later this year, but those are what I've been working on. And I'm on an episode of Projection Booth that probably drops in a few days, might be out before this, on the film Pretty Poison, the Tusi Weld, Anthony Perkins, Noel Black film. So that's some of the things I've been doing.
Awesome. And you can find me, well, if you haven't checked it out yet, I did 10 episodes of a podcast called Uptown Song Club that I'm proud of about music. That all still exists on the Now Playing Network. I'm also the co-host of a podcast, 96 Greers, about the films of character actor Judy Greer. The last episode was on Addicted to Fresno, which is a Jamie Babbitt, director of But I'm a Cheerleader, sort of underseen comedy from 2015 that is very funny. It's a podcast I really enjoy doing. And every episode sort of reveals more and more about the actor in a way that builds on itself that I'm very much enjoying. So definitely go check out 96 Greers, also part of the Now Playing Network. There is another spiel that I think Jim always does at the end of these podcasts about all the great podcasts on Now Playing Network or where you can email us. And I don't know any of that. And that's quite all right. It's the internet. You can find us. Until next time, I'm Patrick Ripoll saying good night.
And thank you for listening.
我想起月下，我想起花前，多少的往事留在我心田，一半是心酸，一半是甜蜜，一年又一年，常将我留恋。